Blog Talk Radio.
Praise God, and welcome to Omega Man Radio. I'm your host, Shannon Davis. This is our late night show. It has been a busy day, my friends. First, I got hardly any sleep last night. It wasn't that I was particularly restless, but we did some programs. We did several deliverances yesterday, and I decided to watch a series called The Alaskan Experiment. Downloaded it on Netflix. You know, this group of people are dropped off into the Alaska wilderness, and they have to make their way, I think, 60, 70 miles back to civilization. And it's an addicting show. I kid you not. It's a clean show. But I would finish one episode and had to watch the next, and then I looked at the clock and I said, Lord, have mercy. I've got to get up in the morning. There's a UPS delivery coming. And you know how UPS is, folks. If you're not there, they'll leave you the notice. And so I said, I can't miss this. So, you know, I finally went to sleep, got about 2 hours of sleep, and then got up today. Knew we were going to have a long day. We had Dr. Prophet Jonathan Hansen from World Ministries International on Channel 1 today at 3 p.m. He led a National Day of Prayer service. Powerful word. If you missed that, it's in the archives. Had a little brief respite after that show before we started program two tonight. We just finished 3 hours with John Kyle of the Oasis Church. Mega Man Radio Channel 1, if you missed that. Powerful mass deliverance. We took a call for Sister Sue that's desperate for deliverance and healing all the way from Manchester, England. She called in. We prayed with her on Skype. Went round one with the enemy. It's not over till the fat lady sings. As my father used to say, we're going back for those demons. We're marinating them right now in the blood of Jesus. And if you're tuning in right now, we've got an awesome program planned for you. Now, you know, I knew we were going to come under some attacks. The enemy already tried to start it tonight. It took me 10 minutes to get this program up and running. It started to malfunction for no apparent reason. I know the witches and the warlocks are not happy that we're having Russ Dizdar on tonight. Because he's on to the tricks. He's been exposing them in the church. Embedded witchcraft everywhere around, folks. It's true. The witches and warlocks are praying every day, we're told at 6 p.m., against churches, against the men and women of God. They're infiltrating the churches, and we're going to get some updates on what they're up to right now from a man who's been tracking them for some time. The enemy did not want this program to happen, but that's all right. We're going to push through, and it's going to happen. And if you're here for the first time, praise God. God bless you. You're welcome here. Demons are welcome to come, too, and then they're going to get cast out in the name of Jesus. I'm looking at the clock. It's 11:11. We talked about 11:11 last night. We'll get to Russ's take on the numbers that people are saying. 333-444, 11:11. Even 9/11, we've been seeing them, haven't we? The wicked and the righteous. Well, without further ado, I've got to locate Russ. I think he's on the switchboard right now. Stand by. Let's try the first line. Is that you, Russ?
Hey, this is Russ.
Russ, there's the man I was looking for.
Praise well, I'll God, tell you brother. What. Praise God, brother, too. And we had the same thing. I was on the computer for the last hour. We were working on all kinds of stuff. About 5 minutes till 11, everything shut down. All the entire internet here shut down. And so it took me about 10 minutes to get everything going again. So here we are. The Lord won.
Amen. Praise God. You know, brother, I was logged into Blog Talk, and I could hear the announcer, but it wouldn't show me in the chat room. I mean, it wouldn't show me in the switchboard. Never had that happen before. Do you want to open up this program tonight in prayer and bind some of these powers out there that are trying to attack the program?
I think so. I think we need to do that. Father, in Jesus' name, we just simply come right now, and all those in the chat room can join in. We just simply come right now to pray. Stretch out your hands, Lord. Crush the work of the enemy. We rebuke you. workers of darkness right now. Just the demonic that would have come against the show. And anyone operative using those powers to do something, again, we just come against that power. In Jesus' name, expose it. In Jesus' name, we ask it to be crushed and broken. Father, we just pray the Holy Spirit lead tonight and guide tonight. Reach out to every single heart. Save, heal, and deliver. Show your great power. Even extraordinary things in the name of Jesus tonight. We love you. Thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Brother, it's an honor and a pleasure to have you on the program. You have been in the ministry for a long time. For those tuning in to you for the first time, give out your website information and give us the story. What's going on with Shadow of the Darkness? What's it all about?
Sure. Yeah, sure. Shadowthedarkness.net on the web. That's where everything can get you can get to everything from there. But it all started about 36 years ago. Prior to that, I was just into occultism, drugs, fighting in bars, drinking, running around. But I, in order to straighten out my life, I got into a martial arts system that drew me into Buddhism, and then I joined where the temple was under a master to learn Golden Buddha, how to leave your body, how to get to the ascended masters, how to, you know, so there was a whole barrage of spiritual experiences in the end of the 60s, early 70s, all kinds of things we were going through, but in all of this spirituality stuff that I was into, all of this engagement and experiences, I mean, we were really having some weird, and voices, I mean, these entities actually were coming, and we, you know, I thought Buddha was a good guy, but none of it ever led me to God or directed me in that direction. It kind of preoccupied me. So, what happened one night is a guy showed up. We were having a party at our apartment, and we had dozens of people there, just packed out upstairs, downstairs, probably 40, 50 altogether. And someone who had gotten saved the week before and became so strong as a witness walked into the party, literally just cleared out. I mean, just started sharing Christ with every single person. And when I heard it, a lot of us, you know, we were like running and hiding and putting our drugs down, and we had no idea. And I ran on the back porch, and I thought, listen, I thought I had to get away from this guy. And I didn't know why. I really didn't know why. I mean, I thought, here I am spiritual. I'm sitting back there thinking, why am I hiding? I'm spiritual. I'm into Buddhism. I know things. And he walks out the door. And when he walked out the door, I could barely look at him because the presence he had, the power that he had, it was clean. It was all I could say is it was right. It was clean. It was the real thing. And I knew what he had, I didn't have. And he just unleashed Christ on me, shared Jesus, told me what I needed to do. I was so I don't even know how to explain it, just absolutely kind of afraid of him, and I had to get out. So I left my apartment, left all those people there, and drove 20 miles to my mom and dad's house, and I just went down and said, I'm staying here tonight, and went down to my old basement. There's a picture of a demon coming out of a circle on the wall. There's acid drops still in the old orange-red shag carpeting. All this stuff in this room down there, all this party stuff, all these books. And I tried to go to bed, but for hours, every time I closed my eyes, all I could think about was Jesus and who he really is and what he's all about. See, I wasn't raised in church. I didn't know nothing other than bits and pieces. And when this guy unleashed, and again, there was tremendous love there, but there was a fire. There was a power that I had never felt. And you know, after 4 hours of just battling in my head, I rolled off the bed and I just said, Jesus, I don't know everything about you, but what I do know is you're God, you're the Savior, you're what this guy told me tonight, and I want you to just save me, deliver me, set me free, Jesus, come into my life, cleanse me, forgive me. And I'm telling you what, I just poured out massive confession, and I staunchly in my heart said, I get rid of everything, God. I don't care what anybody thinks anymore. Jesus, fill my life. Fill me with your spirit. As that man told me tonight, you have power for me. That was 36 years ago. Jesus flooded into my life. The Spirit of God flooded into my life that night. I was there for hours just in relationship, talking to the Lord, just knew that I was saved. I didn't know all the terminology yet. I had to go to Kmart the next day to buy a Bible because I had no idea where to go to buy a Bible. I didn't know where to go to church. I'd never been. And so from that moment, and then just the doors, my friends got saved. I shared how I got saved with my other buddies, and we saw person after person get saved in a 2-3 week period. And that's where it all began. And then from there, Bible school, things like, I mean, I just launched out immediately into Bible school and working and doing ministry and trying to learn. And for the first time in my life, getting a Bible and reading it, I couldn't put it down. I just kept reading and reading and reading. In hours in the night, all of us would get around and just read. I mean, we were like, this is like Cheech and Chong getting saved. And two days later, trying to read the Bible for yourself and learn. And we were astounded. But all we knew was we got saved. God's power came in our life, so we wanted to tell everybody. So we were telling all our friends. Some of them thought we were crazy. Some of them got saved on the spot. And, you know, all I know is that this Savior, I was just a sinner, just a rotten gut sinner that got saved. That's all I am, a sinner that got saved. And this Savior is alive, and he's never left me in 36 years, and he's God, he's King, he's Lord, and that's all I know. All I know is I'm compelled by him, like you, to share Jesus with anybody I can. God loves, you know, wants people saved, wants people delivered, yes. And of course, this launched us into doing deliverances, and then, gosh, 30 years ago, we ended up with satanic ritual abuse cases, and it just launched into that side, and we felt compelled, and I told the Lord way back then, we're not going to turn anybody away, because we were finding that there were churches that wouldn't touch this kind of thing, and I couldn't understand that. I really couldn't. And so as I was growing and getting in ministry and going to Bible school and doing stuff, I was always in ministry direct, and so when we launched into this field in the 1980s in a kind of a formal way, we started this group called Shatter the Darkness, and we were targeting kids that were in Satanism, which led to parents and adults, which led to covens, which led to heavy-duty victims and a whole network, and then from that time to now, thousands that just demonized and trashed, and we've engaged covens and workers and people come into the house and seen. We heard so much of the demons screaming, yelling. I know Jesus, yes. Christ is Lord God, and He's real. But what everybody we need to let people know that the ramping up of this dark side is so broad and big right now. And there's so many demonized, so many infected and attached to and possessed. Across the land, they're literally crying out for. I can't get to everybody. I wish I could.
Russ, it's. That's amen. You know, a couple comments on that is, God took you as you were. You know, He doesn't expect us to get everything cleaned up and come to Him. He'll take us just as we are. Is that right?
I didn't know anything different. I just knew that night when that man poured, and I can look back and say, wow, that was the Spirit of God. I was convicted. I was drawn. God just, you know, literally brought me to that point to where I had to give in. I gave in to Jesus. And when He came in, flooded in, I mean, this was like the Apostle Paul. I had an experience of Christ coming in, just being inundated with, I didn't know what to say other than spiritual power. I mean, I know now the Holy Spirit, but yeah, I mean, you got to understand, when this is a person that barely made it through high school, wouldn't even read a book, because I was too interested in fighting and girls and bars and drugs and every spiritual experience except God or church, until Jesus Himself just, and from that moment, I can only tell you that He is utterly faithful, never leaves you, forsakes you, deals with you along the way, builds you, and it's just an awesome privilege to be able to do this very day. People sometimes come and say, wow, Russ, you did this, you did this. No, no, you got to understand, all I am is a sinner, total rot gut sinner that got saved. And all I care about is seeing people get saved, and Jesus can save, heal, and deliver today, no different than He did 2,000 years ago.
Amen. Folks, whatever you've been involved in the past, we've been involved in some terrible things, many of us. God can forgive you. When he forgives you, he doesn't remember it anymore. There's not anything that God can't put together. You know, Russ, I talk to broken people every day. I've been broken much of my life. And, you know, we fall off the wall like Humpty Dumpty and, you know, shatter into hundreds of pieces. But, you know, he can super glue us back, folks, with the Holy Spirit. And he can put us back together. Now, Russ, from that point when you came to the Lord, your life went on the fast track, didn't it? Tell me about your first experiences in deliverance. When did you begin to see the reality of the dark side, that there are things called demons out there?
Well, you know, I think the first thing that occurred was this. Probably two weeks or three weeks prior to getting saved that night, we were still going to the temple where we would sit and the master would tell us how to be, you know, silent and passive and empty ourselves. It was in that two-week experience that we did have an engagement, an out-of-the-body experience. All I can tell you is what occurred. It was all, you know, there was some presence there and entities. A friend of mine was there at the same time when all this occurred. And we really thought we engaged some high masters and, you know, we wanted to go, but we, you know, when we, you know, got out of that experience and, you know, we're wanting to do it again that next week and a half, we wanted others to come in and do this with us and experience it. That was so real. Well, listen, when I got, when the Spirit of God was in that man and he preached Jesus to me, it was just the power of God so different that when I got saved and he came into me, I knew that there was like total forgiveness and total deliverance. I wasn't possessed, but I knew that I had opened doors and renounced those. But here's what happened. Right away, in starting to go to church, got that Bible. People were taking me to all. I had no idea what a church was, what a rabbi. I didn't know a priest. I didn't know the difference. When I first was reading the Bible, I said, "Hey, I read this thing in the Book of Paulsms." And they're all laughing at me. The Paulsms. I said, "Yeah, it's right there in the middle of the Bible. Look at Paulsms. it's Psalms. I mean, you got to understand. I'm looking at this Book of Job where Satan was, you know, bothering him. And so I'm saying, yeah, the Book of Job. And I'm telling. I was so completely I didn't know what a pew was. So in the first few weeks of getting saved, it was hilarious. It really was hilarious because you got these guys coming in. And again, I mean, it's like Cheech and Chong that got saved, and all of a sudden you're bringing them to churches. They're taking me to Assemblies of God, to Baptist churches and whatever. And there's great things, and I'm just going up hugging everybody. I'm saved. I'm telling everybody, I'm saved. Well, I went home from a Bible study, and here's where I really the first engagement in this way occurred. I went down that same basement where I was at my mom and dad's house, and I already ripped off things from the wall and tried to get rid of. I went around and found 8-track tapes, Lucifer's Friend, Black Sabbath, all these groups I was into. Everything that I got, nobody had to tell me. I knew. I gathered it in laundry baskets, took it outside. We lived in the country, filled the burner out there, poured gas on it, lit it all. Ouija boards and books on spells and all the things that we, you know, knew. That night I go to bed, and I'm telling you the truth. This is just my experience. God knows this is the truth. I laid down on the couch down there, and all of a sudden I felt the most ominous, horrible, dark presence. See, they don't show themselves that way in the beginning. Earlier it was the ascended masters, spirit guides, they're good guys, they're going to, but now that I'm saved, the Spirit of God's inside, now they're going to show up the way they really are. So all of a sudden I'm down there by myself, only a believer, I think maybe 2, maybe 3 weeks, and I can tell you, I literally felt like something walked across the room. I was paralyzed. There was a lot of fear at that moment. I had no idea of the Luke chapter 10, I've given you authority. I didn't know but 5-6 verses maybe by that time. So all I did is I just said, Jesus, I cried out, I said, Jesus, I don't know what this is, help me. You know, I just really poured it out, and here's what occurred. I woke up the next morning, total, absolute peace in the room. I don't know, all I know that night was calling on Jesus. It's like he cleared the room, and I fell asleep, woke up, never had that experience again. And here's how I really asked the Lord, what was that? And it's like the Lord just, and at that time I didn't know how to really listen, but I just felt that God was saying, this is that presence that was trying to get, you know, get at and get into your life, and it wanted his rights back. And it was like, wow, I mean, that was unbelievable to me. So as we start going out soul winning and sharing, sure enough, an individual manifests. Now, we didn't know, so again, we're yelling and screaming, you know, Jesus, you know, get out of here in the name of Jesus. So we're trying to do stuff in the beginning. Yeah. Again, it's sometimes hilarious, but we had to, you know, we had to learn what authority was. And
you got on
what
job
you know,
training, didn't you?
It is fun. In the, I mean, funny. I mean, literally, you got it. It's like the Three Stooges. I mean, we didn't know what to do. In the church that I was going to, they didn't touch on the subject. And the other church, there's another one I was going to. I mean, they're yelling and praising God. It was good too. But I didn't, you know, in 3 or 4 weeks, you didn't learn any, I mean, some stuff like that. And, but once we did, and again, the priority, and even to this day, the priority is evangelism, but we're open the door, you know, we opened the door along the way to saying, God, because here locally, we had, you know, there's 550 churches. What happened here was 50 or more of them sent any demonized, they just sent them all to us. Even the largest church, 14,000, they send them. And it's like, we go to them and say, listen, don't, you know, you do this.
Amen.
Jesus wants you to do this. And, even the larger church said, Russ, we can't do that. It's not in our theological framework, and it would split our church in half. And that's what I said. I said, you guys got $50 million budget. You got 18,000, I mean, you got 8,000, well, they probably have an attendance of 14, but you got 18 full-time pastors. It's simple. You have the authority of Christ, you know, and sometimes you do pray for exposure and for things to manifest, and you engage, and you learn along the way. You get discernment, and you can sometimes feel it in the room, feel it on a person, and then you engage it, and manifestation occurs. So anyway, we had 100 people from their church end up coming to our offices, and they're all going back, wow, this is so real. Jesus did this. They delivered me from, you know, he delivered me from voices in my head. And so the testimonies kept going. And then they would keep sending more and more people. So truthfully, at times we were wore out. We were, you know, and we would try to train others. And again, I was always into, you know, being trained, and even to this day, never stop learning, never stop, but then training others. And,
amen.
I mean,
you said
it
right. Most churches have no clue. You went in there, they say, hey, you know, I know the Bible talks about deliverance, but that's not for today. Or, you know, that's just for the people that are into you know, witchcraft, that's not for Christians, you know. Can a Christian be demonized, Russ?
Oh, I absolutely believe, and again, I'm glad you used that word. Demonizoid is the primary word. So, yeah, because Ephesians 4 says, you know, be angry but don't sin, don't let the sun go down your anger, and give the devil a topon, a foothold, a legal right to grab a part of you.
Yes.
I don't believe that you can get your spirit, your whole being possessed in the area of total ownership like a lost person, but a believer can. Here's what we said. Every believer goes through being, at times, the enemy comes to attack, like Peter, those guys experienced, and Job even experienced a unique attack. So, or Ephesians 6, we're all going to have, every believer is going to have warfare. You're going to have times when you feel the enemy's, you know, sending those arrows. And so one thing is oppression or attack. We go through that, but we have authority in the armor, and we can clear the air and be strong. But third thing, a believer can open the door by them doing it.
Amen.
And they can get, we call it simply attachment, demonization on the level of attachment. But we've watched where, you know, and we've made pastors, and we've made officers, and we've made psychiatrists. When they have people like this, we make them sit in the room with us and say, okay, you know, the proof's in the pudding. We don't want to tell you about this later. Let's see what happens here. And
Amen.
All of a sudden, a voice will come out and scream, or all of a sudden their head cocks back, and another voice, you can't have them. You know, that kind of thing occurs, or they many times instantly fall to the ground, and it's like a, you know, they're growling, and we've heard all this stuff, but we also have learned we didn't have to scream at the people, and we don't have to address the person, just like Acts 16, command the spirit, stop this, in the name of Jesus, we have authority. And again, when I say we have authority, when Jesus says, I have given you authority, and there's a mission behind that. Don't just appropriate it and wear a badge. The mission is trample the dark side. Overcome
Absolutely.
All the power. And so that's what we see in Mark chapter 1, a compassionate, look what Jesus did there. Look at Mark's Gospel chapter 5. That man was naked, cutting himself. We've dealt with people just like that, so possessed, so absolutely controlled that, taken over, they can hurt people. But when you address the demonic presence, I don't care how much is there, how big the power demons are, whatever, when you, in Jesus' name, and you know your authority, and they'll always try to make you afraid, but you order them. You order them. Just like Jesus taught in Luke 10, you order them, stop this. Don't harm that body. You know you're not going to throw up. There's so many things that they try to do to kind of mess up the thing, but order them, command them to attention, deal with them, and all of them. We learned in the beginning, sometimes you cast out one or two. Well, there's five more in there.
Oh, amen. Most people say, if I have anything, I just have one. We've never seen folks burst with just one demon. They run in packs, like Derek Prince said, gangs, and some people have legions. And I agree with you, Russ. I mean, people forget that we are made up of spirit, soul, and flesh. And the soul's got three compartments, mind, will, and emotions. And so I would agree that if you're a Christian, your spirit is inhabited by the Holy Spirit, sealed to the day of redemption. But, folks, you got the soul, and you got the body the demon can reside in. And, brother, a lot of people say, Jesus paid for all that at the cross. Well, I have to say, yes, he paid for sin, but we've got to appropriate deliverance. It's the children's bread. And folks, if you've got sin that you've opened yourselves up, the demons have taken residence in you, and you've got to kick them out. Some demons have come down the family lines, and hey, we can be serving the Lord and we can miss it sometimes and, open the door. And if we open the door, the devil's waiting to come in. So, I'm like this. We don't need to be ashamed that we have demons. Just repent of the sin, kick them out, and keep that door closed. But let me lead into the next thing, which is witchcraft. I mean, it's so prevalent. This is one of your specialties, Russ. So much about it. Look at Harry Potter, for example. How many millions of kids lined up to go see the movies, bought the book? How dangerous is it to play with witchcraft? A lot of people think, oh, it's cool, I'm just going to dabble in it. I just want to experiment. What can happen playing with witchcraft one time?
Well, it's again the idea of attraction. If I right now, I'm out in the country, it's dark out here right now. If I open the door, and I'm in a sunroom area, and I know this area well now, but if I open this door, in the first 5 minutes, probably nothing's going to happen. But if I open it long enough, there's a big old groundhog out here. Every once in a while, he'll come right to this window and look in. If I leave this door open, eventually some of those critters are going to come.
Yes.
And they're going to smell food. They're going to feel the heat. They're going to want to come this direction. And there might even – we have deer that cross over here. So eventually, if that door is open long enough, if a believer in Christ, with all of the power and grace and might that we do have, neglects their salvation and does open the door, just like the Holy Spirit says, when he commands us not to give room, but if we do give room, again, the demonic can grab onto that area, and demonization can occur to that area that we've opened up to.
Yes.
Now, I will also say this, and I agree with you about the family line issue and whether there's other influences or if we open the door prior to salvation. Nothing, because the proof's in the pudding. There's nothing wrong with saying, Lord, I want to renounce anything and everything that I've ever opened the door to. I don't want to give the enemy any possible room. So even going down and just kind of clearing the air in our own personal lives and clearing the air in our generational sense of lives. But if you've got a kid that has opened up and watched Harry Potter and they want to do the magic and they want to get the stick and they want to do this, they might not get demonized instantly or something, but it begins to open a door. The other side begins to see opportunity. You remember when Satan left Jesus in Matthew 4 because he was defeated, but it says he went and waited for a more opportune time. So if they see little doors to them, if they can get a little crack in the door, then they'll want to go a little further. They'll want to bring a little more influence. There's this satanic synchronicity where they try to arrange things, and they want to drive and lead for that door to open wider. So, going to a psychic, going and have Reiki healing, or, all these different things. You know, Reiki healer, they're counting on what they call the energies that come through them and flow through them in and onto the person for healing. The energy is always connected to the entity.
Yes.
And the entity, being demonic, projects that energy and that ability, counterfeit ability. And so the moment the Reiki person allows that willingly, powers to go through, then that person has just gotten an attachment. They willingly allowed counterfeit presence to grab a hold, give a counterfeit experience. If nothing's done, it can get and lead into darker connections.
Russ, it's so dangerous, folks, that you don't even want to touch it. You know, the word says, can you take fire in your bosom and not get burned? God abhors witchcraft so much that he even said, suffer not a witch to live. He said, if you touch witchcraft, paraphrase, I'm going to curse you down to your third and fourth generation. You know, folks, we don't even need to dabble in it, because you touch it, you bring a curse on you. You can bring a curse on your family that's not even born. It's that serious. It's better to steer clear of it. You know, brother, when I started to investigate this light healing, I heard about it, so I did a little bit of research on it, and I found out what they're doing. And, you know, people go to these people that will lay them on a, put them on a cot or a couch, and then they run their hands over them. You know what I'm talking about. And they basically, they're searching for the disease, and they supposedly cure it with their mystical powers. Folks, the word says don't let any man suddenly lay hands on you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's for our protection, isn't it? Spirits can be transferred even through the touch. Is that right?
Well, yeah, and that's what notice in the scriptures, Jesus doesn't go touching demonized people. In the book of Acts, that's the difference between praying for healing, where God's power can also be released in a touch. In a sense, you see the power of the Lord was present to heal the sick, Luke 5:17. But in demonization, I've just followed the pattern of Jesus. I don't touch folks, unless something where they come to, attack, or, if the demonic manifests, it's just a matter of ordering them, commanding them. And absolutely, if you have somebody, and this is true and it's sad to say, but say you got a sexual pervert rapist that attacks a 12-year-old girl or whatever, and they do what they do, a lot, and they have demonic presence in them, it's most likely that not only did they do the physical, emotional, sexual, horrific thing, but forcing the victim into passivity, secrecy, and pain and hurt, that's the demonic, playground. So you have a transference.
Now they do it. Yes.
Right. A transference from that kind of thing can occur. Or anybody out there playing games sexually, and they go out and they're playing around, and they're with somebody that if somebody has demonic presence in that act, when it's in sin and when it's in that direction, it's very possible for transference to occur.
Amen. And, folks, it's so dangerous that when I go down a mall, Russ, and there's a mall here where I live in Georgia, and they have a area set up for these. It's a group of Korean folks, and they're out there, and they'll try to wave you by, want you to get in their massage chair. You know, brother, I'm not going to get in that massage chair. I have no idea if they're faith healers, Reiki healers, what they're doing. I'm not about to let them put their hands on me, because it's
exactly.
That dangerous, folks. You can lay down there to get your back massage, and you come out with another spirit that you didn't sit down with. It's dangerous. You got to protect yourself. You know, we had the number three devil worshiper in Santeria in New York City, John Ramirez, come on the show a couple times. He's become a good friend. He was giving his testimony, brother, that he would go to funeral homes, and he would go up to dead people. He would just, come in there uninvited. They just probably thought he was a friend of the deceased, and he would go up there and try to get the spirits. that were lingering around the bodies after the person died. Or he would go into hospitals as people were leaving their body to grab their demons. And he said, you know, I would lay hands on them to transfer the spirits into me. It's that serious, folks. You know, you don't even want to touch this stuff. Now, let me ask you a question. We've had people calling from time to time, Russ, that, you know, get a little bit incensed when we come against witchcraft and Satan's kingdom. And then they'll say, well, you know, I'm a witch, but I don't do these things that you're talking about. You know, I'm a white witch or, you know, I'm into nature. Is there any difference at the end of the day between what they call white and black witchcraft?
No, because you're dealing with it's all about source. Pagans, druids, Gardenian witchcraft, Bosque witchcraft, or now there's Michael Ford's Luciferian witchcraft. They may have different practices, like New Agers, the Luciferic invocation, charging of stones and rocks and crystals. So they might have different practices, but the issue is the source. What is the source of the real presence and energies and powers you're tapping into? I mean, a real brotherhood or Satanist may have an ancient ritual book with major, precise, ritual format, and they know how to call and want to call powerful, powerful demonic and summon them. Maybe we can touch on the issue of their ritual, the progressive development in ritual warfare. Now, they know what they're doing. A little girl comes in my office, she's 17, her mom brings her. She's just out partying a little bit, smoking marijuana, but then she meets this person, they take her to a store in the neighborhood, and in the back room there's a lady that says she's a witch, and it's a nice thing, and they do spells, and they just talk to the, they call on the powers northeast, south, and west, and they want to do little bonding rituals. They did little things that would seem to be so harmless, and oh, this is just nice. And again, they're going to say a Wiccan like that's going to say it's white power, it's a light level, it's the good side of stuff compared to real Satanism. Well, guess what? She walks into the room. I look at her, and I look right at her. I can feel it, and I said that. Are they telling you not to talk? And she has her teeth clenched, and she says, she shakes her head, yes, yes. So instantly I said, stop it. In the name of Jesus, who are you? But before we did anything else, this thing threw her to the ground. She hits her head on the table, growling. The mother hears it outside. A staff worker's there. I again, stop this. Don't harm this person. In the name of Jesus, who are you? Well, the voice comes out and says who it is. And then again, I always want to know how it got in. So under his authority, how did you get in here? And it says what it did. So we command it out instantly. This occurs in about 8 minutes. She's liberated. How did it happen? Light, what they would have considered light level. Because like I was prior to getting saved, you have no grid of knowing what that energy or light level or spirit guide or family guide or animal spirit or the data from the Akashic records. You have no idea what that presence is because they can cloak what they are. They can masquerade. They can
transform themselves, right?
Right. It's an ability to completely perceive you and then morph to where what they need to fool. The whole thing is to mask what they really are to engage you. And so those entities that were talking to me, I thought they were ascended masters. I thought they were these ancient things that if I would have asked them to come into my body, my master said, they'll empower you in martial art abilities. Your power of your chi will expand. Yeah. So it was all about now I'm glad I didn't get to that. I'm glad that a week later I got saved and didn't, because I would have, because at that point I had no grid. I did not have the Holy Spirit. My spirit was dead to God, just like a Wiccan. And they're going to say we do nice things, but once engaged in the proof, once a believer would say we command whatever demonic presence, show yourself what you really are. Now, we've
right
done that
there,
a number of times.
You've seen it manifest.
Yeah.
Have you sat across people and their eyes turn black as coal?
Oh, it's really, yeah. And that's, It is, well, now, and again, it's even worse in satanic ritual abuse where there's multiplicity and everything else. It is unbelievable the depth, the intricacy of the demonization there. But you're right. There is that. I mean, you know what it's like. All of a sudden, you're looking at a human being. This was a 7-year-old girl, or it could be a 50-year-old guy. It doesn't make it. I've had it with a 6-year-old little girl that was down in the basement of the church in the nursery. My wife was there. And she told my wife twice. She turned and pointed. My wife says, "Satan's going to break your arm."
Wow.
Well, it was weird. So my wife brings her up. I get done teaching a class on deliverance. I was teaching a class on deliverance upstairs, small group, 15 people in a church, on a Wednesday night. We were just doing a course. Well, the mother begins to take the little girl to the back. My wife had gone to leave, and I was going to be there a while with people. My wife turns around, drives back to the church, comes in and says, as soon as she opens the door, she looks in. The little girl's there, the mother's there, 12 other people. She says, "The Lord, we need to pray for this little girl. The Lord sent me back here." That little girl, and I'm saying 6 years old, in a little teeny dress, little pigtails, instantly manifested, fell to the floor, vulgar, I mean the most vulgar mouth stuff started coming out, cursing her, cursing everybody, crawling into the pews. The mother actually had to crawl in the pews and drag her out, bring her to the front. I had to get a hold of her in just a soft hold, just you know, because she is literally going wild. But the moment I said, "Listen, we got to pray now," and as soon as we said Jesus, instantly she went limp. The demonic Amen. Presence in her went right under the mother. The mother went to the floor, manifested totally. So we had to command the demonic presence out of the mother, which was into witchcraft, open the door to her daughter through, I believe, abuse and witchcraft that had yes. demonic presence. So we saw instant manifestation, transference, and then when that occurred, because we just literally exploded when we commanded the, you know, this manifestation was so broad. There was a youth group meeting downstairs. All of a sudden, we heard yells and screams. Kids went running out of every door because kids that had open doors down there and maybe some level of attachment, all of a sudden, this demonic presence went bursting out of this lady. I don't know if it just like went through the building or whatever, but looking for whatever places, they were like almost instantly attacked. So we had to do this broad, you know, prayer and dealing with all these kids, but it yes. all began yeah. with a 6-year-old little girl that just looked at the demonic presence on her, in her, looked at my wife, knowing who she, and they know who we are. I mean, they know Paul, I know Jesus. They know, the demonic know who we are instantly.
Amen.
But that little girl, out of her mouth, and you can see her eyes black as coal, and when the demonic left her, her eyes and her body went to complete peace, and her eyes went back to her beautiful little color. But it went on her mother, and then we had to deal with the mother, then we had to deal with the kids, and it was crazy, but it demonstrated two things: how real the demonic side is. It wasn't some heavy-duty Satanist, you know. This was someone that was into witchcraft and abuse, and it was bad enough. And I hate to see it in children, but it's usually because parents have opened the door. As far as children are concerned.
Amen. But, that, folks, man, that's why you don't want to open it up. You can transfer spirits down the family lines. You know, Anton LaVey said there's no difference between black or white witchcraft. They all worship Satan. And even the lower level, you know, initiates, if you want to call them that, that may not know what they're doing when they get involved. They may not be privy to some of this information that you get as you work up the ranks. But at the top, they all understand who they're worshiping. They're worshiping, you know, Satan, Baphomet, you know, Lucifer, and it's evil, folks. You don't even want to touch it. Now, I've got a series of questions I want to ask you while I have you on tonight. It's just an honor to have you on tonight. If you're just tuning in, folks, we've got Russ Dizdar on here tonight. This is a live show. Russ, give out your website and your contact information, please.
Sure. If they want to go to Shatter the Darkness, one word, shatterthedarkness.net, and that's the main site that connects everything, that has everything. And take your time if you go there. It's a busy site, but that's the main site, shatterthedarkness.net.
Russ, what's happening to the kids that were on the milk cartons? Where are all these kids going that are being supposedly kidnapped every year. Are any of them being used for sacrifices?
There's no question that has happened on two tiers of this issue. On the one hand, as we began to work with satanic ritual abuse, deals with multinational, multigenerational, very historic, four generations, maybe now even going to a fifth generation of kids, dealing with people from their 80s all the way down to five. This is the where they have the ritual books that have human skin and blood in the ink that have written. This is the deep stuff. This is the stuff they know what they're doing.
We heard the other day that there was some satanic festival called Beltane. A lot of people don't know what it is. I didn't know what it was. What is Beltane, and is that one of these that you're talking about where maybe there were some sacrifices that night?
Oh, absolutely. As a matter of fact, we keep an eye on the ritual calendar. We didn't know at the beginning, but when we along the way, we begin to find out that, first of all, there's some estimates, secular estimates sometimes, of 10 million of these ritually abused, multiple, where they split, where they really are trying to transmute the human being. Now, this is the deeper, serious side, but it has everything to do with those missing kids, because in their field, they want to look for, and if anybody looks at the satanic calendar, you'll notice that prior 10 days, 14 days prior to Walpurgis night, the 30th, this last weekend, which some would call Beltane, the next day, the May Day, and so forth, it all centers around, whether it's pagan, Wiccan, they all have their different celebrations, but it is a primary, massive night for dark Satanism, and it's a human sacrifice night. And
okay,
on the
so
calendar, it'll tell you. It'll tell you that.
They're kidnapping people for human sacrifice. Are they taking some and basically they're never heard from again? They turn them into breeders?
Well, you tell me how far I need to go with the show to tell details, because in the midst of this, because of what we did, law enforcement drew us in, made me a police chaplain only because they wanted me to teach occult crime stuff to the academies, where they then took us to police academies back in the 90s. In this massive rise, they had such an unprecedented rise in the United States of Satanism, satanic crimes, satanic victims, missing people. It was so vast, Shannon, that they had to begin to create in every department, every cop department, every law enforcement department nationwide were creating training or developing a unit or a detective that focused on satanic ritual crime and occult crimes. So we've been brought into many of the high-level trainings that cops do. Of course, they don't want to deal with the spiritual side. They tell their officers, don't deal with that side, just deal with the crime. But the motivation and what they needed to begin to look for then was many of these ritual crimes. Like we have one here where a 14-year-old girl and a 17-year-old girl slaughtered in a horrific, detailed bloodletting ritual that involved perverted sex, bloodletting. This little 14-year-old, this little 7-year-old would have went through an hour or more of horrific torture, horrific pain, horrific terror, all because that draws energy and raises the energies so that the demons can latch on. They latch on to the blood issue, to the energies raised. And here's
they
the
demand
reason.
Blood sacrifice, don't they? And so as people are working their way up in the ranks of Satanism and witchcraft and Wicca, the demons start to demand blood sacrifice, don't they?
Absolutely.
And if they
and
don't,
here's again.
They get brutally punished, don't they?
Well, exactly. And the demons demand what they demand, and they will give stuff to get more entrenchment. But what we've seen in the United States, and this goes back to the, and this is where, believers who are Bible, you say, I love my Bible, but I haven't heard of this. Okay, go back to 2 Kings chapter 21, 22, 23. Manasseh opens up every door possible to every kind of demon, God, spirit, starry host, whatever. The encroachment is so broad in Jerusalem and in the nation that even in the temple, that's supposed to be the temple of God, they've got Asherah poles, they've got symbols on the doors, they've got Moloch. Manasseh sacrifices his own son. When you open the door a little bit, it will always, Shannon, always lead ultimately to the number one door the dark side needs. It is the most powerful door. It opens the most broad door. human sacrifice, the Aztecs, in one description, had 136,000 human skulls of victims who they sacrificed. Human sacrifice factory, the Mayans, the last 2 years before the demise, 50 to 70,000 from those ziggurat, those stairways where the heads rolled. The descriptions of the sacrifice, horrific, bloodletting, curling, painful, 50 to 70,000. So they, everybody looks, well, that's the past, that's the ancient past. No. United States of America, at the very minimum, 4.5 million diagnosed cases, satanic ritual abuse, which involves the multiplicity and all the rest, which means this. Every victim was brought up in a coven since childhood.
God have mercy. No wonder the Mayans and the Incas and all those Aztecs disappeared. They were sacrificing them all. Folks, and those that probably didn't get sacrificed, they fled. I would too. Let me ask you a question. How common and widespread is witchcraft in America? Could you be working at a job and the person sitting next to you be a witch or a warlock, and you not even know it?
Yeah, and there's an underground side that's really steeped in supernatural darkness. Now, Shannon, that's the worst part of it. That's the largest part is the real darkest side, where, like the scripture talks about, a secret power of lawlessness. They are laced. They even have specific rituals to summon demons to cover them in invisibility and hiddenness. Many cases, law enforcement cases, whether with Dahmer or the Matamoros case, some of those cases deal with, they summon demons not only for themselves but also for protection, blind officers, keep anybody from detecting them. Here's what we found out. Every city in the United States in the last 20 years, as we've tracked, victims of ritual abuse. There's victims of ritual abuse in every single city in the United States. There's a reason for that.
In Boston, or excuse me, Salem, Massachusetts, what is it, like 3 or 4 out of 10 are probably witches or warlocks or judges, they're police officers, they're doctors or school teachers. I mean, if you want to look at America, and I will show you a map, where would be the highest concentration of these covens where all these witches or warlocks are congregating? Where would you say is the capital?
Sure. I you know, it's some say, this is what some have said worldwide, that Victoria, British Columbia is second to Geneva, Switzerland. In the United States, though, I would have to say bigger centers like New York, like Los Angeles, like Chicago. But I listen, in our tracking, like in the city I live in, every city in the United States has a psych ward that has demonized people that have been through ritual abuse, which means this one factor. Every single place you find a real, ritually abused individual, like on that level, means that there's a coven there in that town. And it's had to have been there 30, 40 years.
Wow. Now, that's when you say serious coven, what is the definition of that? Is it a certain number of witches and warlocks? Is it just witches, female witches? What is it?
It involves, yes. It's kind of like denominations, really. It's like you can have Anton LaVey's Satanism style. You can have Temple of Set style. You can have psycho-Satanism like Richard Ramirez. You can have self-styled. But you can also have the Ancient Brotherhood. That's the largest, the most secretive, the most deadly. That is where they're – that I would I'm saying in my testimony – I mean our research, there is that kind of coven in every city. Now, then you can go to – different kinds of witches, though. There's different kinds. And then pagans, and now druids, and now Santeria, Palomomi, the Apocwa.
Oh, yes.
There's like in New York, I mean, if you're from the New York area, there's not only Santeria, but there's Palomomi. We have the drug lord issue. You know, the drug lords in Mexico, by the billions of dollars that they're, you know, getting, they hire priests and priestesses to summon the powers. They'll offer human sacrifice to Santi Murti to cloak them and bless the drug trade.
Wow.
Pharmacon, the drug issue, is they're actually summoning powers to cloak them, to go against law enforcement, and to bless the drug, disseminate their drug trade.
Russ,
now that is
can witches Can they cast spells on even pharmaceutical drugs, on records, on music? And when you buy the product and you use it or you listen to it, that demon goes inside of you? Is it that serious?
It's. I mean, when I like, there's that movie Fallen out there. If you're a believer, it's not that, like, there's websites that you can go to that that Satanists have been, kind of demonized their website. They can also demonize an object. And so, yeah, I mean, I would say, like, walk into a house where there's been demons raised and ritually. Now, I could feel that. They might want to harass or come against or try to get a headache or sickness or whatever. Well, as a believer, I know what to do. But it can affect you, yes.
Amen.
There are people, and like I could mention a website right now. I won't do it. I'll tell you about it off air if you want me to. But it's a website people can go to. You can get what we in law enforcement and other places saw 20 years ago in confiscated books, confiscated materials, books that wouldn't be even sold on Amazon or Borders. Now, of course, now they got everything. But now this website, they'll have detailed rituals, human sacrifice, the black mass, chaos rituals, how to summon spirits and send them against pastors, against Christians, how to do a human blood. It is unbelievable the access now.
Brother, that's what I want to talk about next. Because I went into a Books A Million store, for example, and I walked past this aisle, and I looked over. They've got a Ouija board. They've got Necromonicron. They had a whole set of shelves with every kind of evil occultic book you can imagine. And I looked, and, you know, people were standing there. They're reading them. You know, they're interested in taking these homes. And we got reports that there are places you can go on the net and you can buy a spell. You know, you can have a demon of incubus to be your own, very own, to have sex with. You can buy these things. You can buy love potions. Brother, this is hardcore demonic. And that's why I have such a desire to shut the covens down. You know, these people aren't out there just, worshiping trees and dancing naked in the woods, folks. There are people that want to kill you. There are people that are astral projecting to take your life. And we've got to stand up because people are dying, Russ. I had a report from Rich Keltner, Watchman Radio, who's been attacking the host of hell in Philippines, and the witches showed up out there. And you know what? They grabbed some personal articles of one of the people there. I think they got some saliva that was spit on the sidewalk outside. They scooped that up. They got a piece of clothing that disappeared, and they started doing summoning and invoking demons. Next thing you know, the person was being attacked by a spirit of leukemia. They found it out when they interrogated it. Found out it had been sent to them from all the way from the Philippines to attack them. Folks, these people want to kill you if they could. You know, and Satan's modus operandi is to kill, steal, and destroy. My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. You know, here recently, brother, we came under a lot of attack doing these programs. You know, the enemy doesn't like the fact that we're trying to pull the cover off him. Now, I've only been in it a year. You've been in it over three decades. I know the enemy doesn't like you. And so, you know, we started to come under attack. We saw people that were struck with infirmities, physical attacks, depression. I went through a bout of depression for 2 weeks, almost shut down the show last summer. And many other people were coming under attacks. Marriages were being broken up. And I said, this is some hardcore witchcraft going on here, and I'm not going to stand by, or I'm going to become a casualty if I don't, you know, go into attack mode. You know, folks, you've got to either attack them or they're going to attack you, because the demons are coming after you. Whether you want to believe that Satan exists or a Christian can have a demon, that just makes it easier for them to attack you. You know, the Bible is rife with the fact that the enemy's real, and that's who we're wrestling against, not flesh and blood, and that God has given us armor and weapons for a reason, to attack the host of hell. So that's what I'm trying to do. I want to turn the tables, Russ, on the enemy, and what I want to know is, how do we attack back? Because clearly, these witches are organized. They're not minding their own business, are they? Am I correct in saying that the witches actually organize and they say, we're going to go into the church, try to work our way in, get the pastor to fall into lust, temptation, work our way into positions of authority? Are there witches in churches right now? is the question.
Absolutely. I will say across the United States, Canada, Australia, Europe, there is a plot. You know, this is, it's not just a little random thing here or there. This is something we've tracked back to the 70s now, where they have literally, you know, placed individuals. We have gone through the whole scheme they use in coming into a local fellowship, how they do it, how they can fake I want to get into the Lord. I want to get into Bible study. I need you to help me. I want to see the pastor. And we've gone through a litany of their actual methodology they use, how they come in, and all the while if they've been sent in, and if you recognize you've got somebody that now confesses, yes, I've been sent in, this is what it means. Prior to that sending in and you knowing who they are, a coven has already started summoning and targeting you. They understand targeted spiritual warfare. They understand, just like Revelation 16, when the beast, the dragon, the false prophet send the demons out to directly target the kings of the earth, they know how to send, you know, the hounds of hell after you. So, and they'll want to be there to grab articles of clothing, get a picture off a bulletin, take whatever they can take back to a coven to do the rituals using those points of contact. We've been to numerous churches called in to ask what happened to us here. We've engaged former highly trained infiltrators, very highly trained. And then we've tracked when they use demonized objects to come in and give you a gift, want to constantly give you things, even food they would bring in. And all of a sudden, people get headaches, people get sicknesses, people, confusion comes into the church, division. They know how to even manipulate and go to five different people and say, oh, so-and-so said this, so-and-so. They know how to bring division and manipulate, and they're very... It burns my britches to, you know, engage this and see this happen, because not only has it, you know, years ago when we had four or five or six individuals that were coming to the local church I was pastoring at the time, well, then we realized some of them, they weren't there for help. They weren't there for help at all. They were there only as a planted individual that was learning how to weave their way into every counselor, every worker. They take information of every single person there. It's almost like they're on reconnaissance, and they take all the information back to the coven.
God have mercy. It's almost like, sure, we've got to deal with Trojan horses, okay? Folks, did you hear what he said?
Yeah.
You know, I believe it. Let every word be established within the mouth of two or three witnesses. What you just said, I know people that went down. They were given, for example, some Indian artifacts, you know, maybe a dream catcher, some other stuff, some Indian artistry. Next thing you know, all hell broke loose in their family. And it turned out a witch had given them that as a gift, and that's all they needed to have the legal right to come through the threshold. Is that right? I mean, so if you have an accursed object, can that give Satan authority to come into your home and attack you?
It's like having something that's toxic. You know, all of a sudden somebody gives you something. And again, I'm not going to say, for example, here's what occurred. I'm in an office. We're doing a lot of public training, public stuff here locally in the area. It gets into the newspapers. So a girl shows up, comes to my office unannounced. This is a girl that had tattooed on her left wrist, War on the Saints. We dealt with her at a different church where we took her book of Shadows.
Wow.
Where she had described in the Book of Shadows how she was going after that pastor, his wife. They were doing blood sacrifices. Cops caught her and another guy in the building doing with blood in a Bible and burning it right at the altar in that Bible church there in Akron, Ohio. Well, this person shows up one day at my house. Or not my house, my office up here at the big church. And she sits there. She's talking to me. I'm behind my desk. And she's talking a while, being polite. And I'm like, something's wrong here. And, of course, she knows I'm always witnessing to her. She came there because she knew that I had a French version, hand-typed version of the Black Mass. She wanted it. I said, there's no possibility. A law enforcement agent gave it to me. I said, no, there's no way I'm going to give it to you because it's the real thing out of France. And she leaves. So I'm sitting there, and I'm saying, Lord, she didn't come just to talk. What's going on here? I go over by the couch where she was sitting. I actually knelt down and began to pray, looked up to my right, and I noticed she always wore these two black, she called them power rings,
just like an amulet around the chest.
Really?
Where they would demonize the rings or the power, the amulet, or, you know, they all have, you know, serious ones will have jewelry that has, that are demonized, like the Old Testament's devoted object, a demonized
okay,
object.
So, well, like the Masons, I've seen the Masonic rings and I've identified them. I sat with a guy actually that was in Panama and I looked over at his hand. He came and joined me and another buddy for lunch and he had this ring. So I knew he was a Mason, but you see these skull rings that some people wear. Is there any particular jewelry that they have as a common denominator that you might spot on someone and be able to, it'll give them away?
Again, there's certain kinds that do, like an inverted pentagram is going to deal with real Satanism. A pentacle will be more like witchcraft. So there are signs, there's so many sign symbols and so forth. The Oberutus, the snake swallowing itself. It could be on tattoos also, by the way.
Okay.
You know, particular, in the Old Testament day, or in the, among the, you know, Maya, not everybody does it this way, and I don't, it's not about going to the debate about so-called skin art and all that kind of stuff, but please understand, its origins were pagan.
Amen.
And the issue is this. They primarily did it with a sigil or a symbol that was directly related to the demon or the demon's name or what they perceived spiritually the demon looked like. So when that gets put onto their skin, the demonic has the right to attach to that sigil or to a symbol or to what it is they inspired them to put. No different than a demonized object. We have, and again, like little Sean Sellers on Oklahoma years ago, young Satanist, learning a lot on his own, learning from other people behind the scenes. He goes into his closet, has a ritual thing there where he's drinking blood, human blood, things like this. Here's what his own words were this. He took off the protective demonized object that he was wearing around his neck. Instantly, he felt his chest expand as he knew the demonic presence came in.
Wow.
He picked up a gun. He walked in and he shot his mother in the head and he shot his stepfather in the head and killed both of them.
God have mercy.
You know, he was on death row. Listen, I'm telling you that among criminologists, we have to understand many crimes are motivated. Jeffrey Dahmer was a deep Satanist. He lived 30 minutes from me, 20 minutes from where I live.
Oh my
he
goodness.
Was raped. He was a multiple. I got to look at, when I was, I'm tech SWAT team training area on advanced cult crime, the officer comes in, brings out all these books of Jeffrey Dahmer's apartment in Wisconsin. He wasn't just some crazy guy people thought, the newspaper said, just a crazy pervert. No. He had an altar formed and built out of human thigh bones.
Oh my
he God. Had a power cone, which is a triangle shape where you summon demons to contain them, built out of human skulls. He was so deep into Satanism, the deepest, darkest kind you can imagine. He was so deep into it, but again, law enforcement, they're trained, well, don't bring that out, don't tell. Or John Wayne Gacy, or Ted Bundy. These are guys that had demonic presence and even had the issue of sub-personalities that motivated them.
What about that Ramirez? Richard Ramirez, was that his name?
Absolutely. Richard Ramirez in California, the Night Stalker. He was so highly demonized, but he was a self-styled, what we would call self-styled, or I would call, when I give a kind of a, we have a training course that has 25 hours, it's called Satanism 101. It goes over all the differences, it's all free for anybody who wants it, but it goes over all the differences, how to spot signs, symbols. He was a self-styled, kind of a psycho-Satanist, in the sense that he practiced what he could get a hold of. He got highly demonized. But Shannon, he went in motivated by the demonic stuff, even on ritual dates where he was led, he broke in. The human suffering, pain, and decimation to women and children was unbelievable what he did.
God have mercy.
Unbelievable.
Folks, this is sickening. Even the guy that was involved in, is it Tucson where they had the shooting? Hit that congresswoman, they found an altar in his backyard?
You're right. And again, if you look at Jared, and again, because we've looked at this for 30 years now, when I look at Jared, I see subpersonality, demonized subpersonality stuff in him. There's something more to him than there was to anybody's observation as far as law enforcement. Now, here's what's occurring. He was supposed to kill himself. He tried, but of course they grabbed, you know, the extra clip and they stopped him. And okay, he's in jail, all that kind of stuff. They're going to deal with him on a physical, you know, psychological and criminal aspect. What he did was horrific. What he did, though, was demonically motivated, and a little bit of a test, demonstration of what they can do. Now, here's what occurred. I don't know if you heard about this. Just a few weeks ago, a professor from the school there, sitting on Oracle Road right there in the parking lot area where the killings occurred, this just happened a few weeks ago, chanting in a twilight demonic language. When the cop got there, it's quoted in the article, the cop said this individual would eventually, you know, come out of the trance and look at him and said, "We are the ones you are waiting for. We are the chosen ones."
God have mercy.
Now, the cop didn't know what to do with him and just, of course, took him off.
No, they didn't pick up on the clues. They didn't have the discernment there. Russ, we've got a question from the chat room here. It says, ask Russ if he knows about any demonized movie stars. Now, we hear about some of these cases that when they make the news, but what about Hollywood actors? Some of the rock stars out there, you know, one that comes to mind might be, you know, Metallica, the dude that plays the guitar. You know, I've seen some of this stuff on TV. Are there a lot of witches and warlocks behind the scenes in places like Hollywood and on the music scene?
Listen, there's no question. I mean, when I came out of the 60s, you know, Black Sabbath, Blue Oyster Cult, there's a group called Lucifer's Friend. Now, you got to remember, it's all progressed. It's all gotten, and it's going to continue to get deeper and darker. Here's what we have now as far as darker metal bands and even other groups that are out there, even Lady Gaga, that kind of stuff. What you have is bands like Slayer and Danzig, and here's what happened when I was a police chaplain on the cult crime stuff. They took me into the Jar Arena and took me to the backstage to engage Marilyn Manson, to engage Peter Steele from Type O Negative, to engage Slayer. All these different groups were coming in. What nobody realized, like for example, Marilyn Manson, not only has he got sub-personalities, he is highly demonized.
No
on stage, 4,000 people, you know, he's got these plastic babies, you know, hanging with nooses. He's doing all this stuff. Twice on stage, I'm 7 feet away from him, he's totally taken over by the demonic. His arms are up. It's as if the demonic mounting him is in absolute glee of the screaming adoration of everybody. They're absorbing it. They're unleashing their presence. It made me mad, so I'm praying against it. Now, what happens is he busts up his stage, all goes crazy, busts up his stage, which probably was part of his act, but the cops then that I'm with, they're dragging him off, you know, taking him off, and then when they bring me around, they want me to engage him. So when I get like 5 feet from him, now he was turned sideways. He actually fell to the ground, started growling. He's in a thong. He's in a leather thong. He's all sweaty. I knew I wasn't going to touch him, but his team then just simply slid him and drug him back, so I couldn't engage him directly. Peter Steele from Type O Negative, he came around, definitely into satanic practices. Slayer has a song out of the album called South of Heaven, Spill the Blood. Now, that's a song that I believe is under was given by demonic inspiration. And so it's literally a ritual song that can be used in a ritual where the listener is invited to shed their own blood, spill their own blood, give yourself to Satan, just like a satanic. Well, I've got one's called the Devil's Bible in the back. It shows you step by step how to surrender, go through a ceremony of ripping the Bible apart and all these things, and opening up for demonic presence to directly come in.
Russ,
Rules
of engagement. I went over to. Here recently, I've been going to Marilyn Manson's Facebook page. People ask me why. They say I must like the music. I said no, but in order to be able to post on all these sites, folks, you have to mark you like them. But anyway, we're going to try to pluck some people out of the fire, and I go over there and I put the link to the show up there. And you know, he's got 1.5 million people I just checked it tonight, folks. 1.5 million people that worship this guy. And I said, you know, what's the mystique about him? Now, I've heard him interviewed. I think that, you know, the guy, he certainly, he has a level of intelligence there, but he's using it for the dark side. But I heard his own testimony, how apparently, you know, he was going to a Christian school as a child, and he goes into the basement of his home, and he uncovers his box belonging to his grandfather, and he found all these, like, 16-millimeter films, 8-millimeter, whatever, of pornography and bestiality, some really base, perverse stuff that his grandfather was into. And he started to, you know, watch those, and then he became affected. We know now he doesn't even know if he's a man or a woman. You know, he's kind of androgynous. But I've heard that a lot of people that go down this path and get into Satanism, and as they get involved in these actual covens, that they're forced into acts of sodomy. And is that true? Is that going to be what most people are going to have happen to them that go down this path? They're going to end up being sodomized?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's all every kind of sexual perversion. I mean, and they have sex rituals where it's step by step by step. Again, it's up to you whether you want me to tell you the direct stories, even criminal stories. As far as Maryland, the school that you're talking about, it's, you know, it's 20 minutes from my house down in Canton here. That was a Christian school that he went to, but he was placed there purposely. But he has a generational background of some of the deepest, darkest side. And when that perversion comes in, Shannon, in satanic rituals, part of the preparation for a deep ritual is sexual perversion. Because this is, again, a way, since it goes against God, it opens the door, it broadens the door for demonic transfer. So in every sex ritual that goes on, there is demonic transfer. There is demonic summoning and transfer. Always.
There's no doubt about it, folks. I mean, the guy's tormented. He cuts on himself. I looked on his page one day, and he was in a suicide pose with his finger to his head. The guy's being tormented. Even look at the recent videos he did up on YouTube, and he talked about how they found an occultic book, and it was an experience. They went down underground in this house, and you know he saw the reality of the demons. You know, the bottom line I'm trying to make here is, the guy's not happy. He's not a happy camper. All the money in the world didn't bring him happiness. He's being tormented. And it's only a miracle of God that he's not already dead. But, you know, I had a friend. This is a true story. A friend named Matthew. I won't give his last name out. I met him in the course of business. He hooked me up with a merchant account one time for a business I was involved in. So a really professional man. And, you know, we maintained a friendship, but I lose track of him for a while, Russ. And I located him again, and I said, "Hey, Matthew, how you doing, my friend?" I said, "You still out in Los Angeles?" And he says, "Don't call me Matthew. My name is now Mateo." I said, "Excuse me?" He said, "Yeah, call me Mateo." He said, "I'm a warlock." I said, "What? Come on, man." He goes on to tell me how he had taken up with a shaman, and he had moved in with this guy, and he said it was like the guy turned the switch in him. He wanted to be turned on. Next thing you know, he's telling me he's doing, he's become a vegetarian. He's doing these rituals involving candles and herbs, and he uses his own blood. And I couldn't believe my ears. This is a guy who was, you know, I sat across the table from him. He was a sane guy. Very good-looking guy. He could have any woman that he wanted, folks, out in Los Angeles. In the course of a year, having hooked up with this shaman and going into witchcraft, brother, the last time I heard from him, he had turned homosexual. He was into gay sex. Demons were being put into him. The guy's life has forever changed. He lost his job, lost everything, and he still thinks he's on the right path. How many people make the mistake of going down that line and they were straight? Next thing you know, they're in a witchcraft coven and now they're homosexuals.
And every other kind of thing. I mean,
every other kind of perversion.
Well, you know? Because you have the well, that's what the whole thing with even the virgin. I mean, even the black mass and the virgin issue. Because again, you're desecrating God's order.
whatever can be used to desecrate God's order, to really, I mean, when you go, the darker you go, for example, here's a ritual that happens, that occurs.
We don't censor this program. This is no holds barred, so go into any level of detail you want.
This is known in law enforcement. This is known in ritual books. This is known in multiple testimonies, but in our engagement. So here's what occurs. They have a man that is dead. They cut off his private parts.
Oh, my goodness.
They sew them on to the private area of a woman. And then they go into a sexual ritual. That's what we're talking about. This is the kind of thing we're talking about. Such desecration, such perversion, having sexual relationship with a dead human skull. This is what we're talking about when we say the underground. You can go back to the scriptures too and go back to Ezekiel chapter 8 where God takes him into where this actual covenant is going on. And God calls it detestable, even more detestable. God literally showed Ezekiel. He was willing to go and God took him in and say, here's what's been going on. Here's what's happening right here. Here's who's doing it. And, so this is nothing new. In all of our studies of ancient practices and so forth, but what the issue is this, and even in law enforcement knows that they know this, the practice of this stuff is like the drug lord issue. You catch 10% of it, the 90% of it continues.
Oh my goodness.
And
that's the sickest of the sick, and that's what demons are about. They're filthy, they're despicable, and they'll do the most base acts, folks, and try to get you to do it. Let me ask you a question. Is the correct term for a person in witchcraft that's a male, is that a warlock and the women are called witches?
Sure. There's different terms. Even like that's in the area of Wicca.
Okay.
They could be a magus. Like in Kralinian, they could be what's called a magus. You can have a polero in Santeria, in Palomombi. You can have a babalao. You can have in voodoo and so forth. So there's different names, different types, but the same source.
Okay.
Some of it would say, well, we don't do human sacrifice. Well, okay, that's a good thing, but you still summon, I don't even care if you call them energies, the energy you feel and get a hold of is the emanation from an entity. If you get the energy, you're going to get the entity, and it's demonic. And so...
Amen.
That's the source issue. New Agers, that's the largest spiritual counterfeit movement in the world today, 400 million or more. They do a thing called the Luciferic Invocation. They're summoning what they would call the Lord of Light. They're literally opening the door to Luciferic presence. They're doing it simultaneously over cities around the world. They believe that they'll actually help bring in, usher in, after the great chaos, they'll usher in a great new order. Well, yeah, they're being used. It's like, think in terms of a lot of believers in prayer meetings praying for salvation and praying for revival. And well, they're doing the same thing on the opposite side. The how broad this has become.
And they're devoted, aren't they, Russ?
Oh, yeah, they're blinded, right, absolutely.
You've got Christians who... How many of us folks don't even read the Bible on a daily basis, or it's collecting dust? God have mercy. We've got the Muslims that worship a demon called Allah three times a day. How organized and focused are these witches and warlocks? They're disciplined, aren't they?
Very disciplined, very committed. For example, this is how we engage. And again, we've sent teams, and we don't tell this a lot, but over 20-some years, we have a small group where we have gone out. We do this to this very day. We were out last weekend on Wool Purchase Night for 4 hours in a car, four of us, and we call it a REAP trip. It's research, it's the exposure, evangelism, and prayer. So we're going to every ritual site place where we know has been used last weekend on Wool Purchase. We're praying over every one of those areas, praying for victims to be found, because there's no question, whoever's a Satanist on whatever level, whoever's a Wiccan on whatever level, whoever's pagan on whatever level, they're going to use Wool Purchase Night to summon powers, summon, and get a hold of things.
Okay,
so
they're out there doing this stuff. And you mentioned one of the ways they like to infiltrate is, you know, Trojan horses, giving people gifts that are cursed objects they take in their home. I'm coming into a lot of contact with people that are talking about these orgone machines, and they're out there selling them and telling people that it wards away demons, you know, get a crystal. The orgone machine, is that not a demon magnet?
It can definitely be a demon magnet because of this. William Reich, a German scientist, he tapped into occult-oriented powers in developing orgone power, orgone energy. So we need to be very careful, because we got to go back to Scripture. Did Jesus ever use orgonite? No. Did he ever, you know, use a bunch of elements to put it all together to ward off demonic presence? No. Did Paul, did anybody in the New Testament, did anybody use this? No. When it comes back to deliverance, Jesus did it the way he did it, taught it the way he did it, and the earliest disciples did it the way Jesus said it and practiced it, and they had the same good results.
Amen.
So it should play no part. I mean, there's times people say, well, I got salt, I'm going to throw salt down. Well, no, look at the New Testament. Old Testament was different in this sense. There was never any direct deliverance. There was no ability for it. That's why when it came to wiping out Nephilim-oriented tribes, demonized tribes, that's why God had to wipe them out. They were so entrenched in Nephilim generation tribes. They were so altered. That's one way in the Old Testament of how things, you know, were cleared out. In the New Testament, now Jesus says, I have given you authority to trample. So now a new level. That's why when he sent them out in Luke 10, they came back and, well, yes, they were preaching the gospel of the kingdom. They were seeing people get healed. But what they were most surprised about was the demons are submitting to us in your name, because that never happened before. They have no history of that.
Right.
In Josiah's day, Josiah had to go and destroy those places and stop all this stuff. And even in that Old Testament day, they killed off the priests. But in this day, there's a different, broader, direct deliverance where we engage the demons directly and can handle that.
Amen.
If we use that, if we really do, and listen, it should be in the first, you know, discipleship 101 should include how to read the Bible, how to pray, how to worship, how to be, you know, in the body, how to learn, you know, to witness to lost people, how to know the power of the Spirit of God, how to know your authority, how to command a demon if you ever, you know, engage something, how to put on the armor of God. That should be done in the first 6 months of a believer's life.
Amen.
And well, if it's done, and you know this, Shannon, if that's done, guess what's going to happen? You're going to have believers from ground level up learning everything Jesus taught them to do. They'll learn to begin to do.
Amen. Folks, this is the truth tonight. What a powerful program this is tonight. I want to continue. Before we do, I want you to give out your contact information again. Tell people how they can reach you, Russ.
Sure. That would be shatterthedarkness.net, shatterthedarkness.net. And just so folks know, too, there's a course called Satanism 101. There's a course called Dark Rituals, Dark Powers. Any of those, they're absolutely free. It's the exact same thing I've used here locally in churches where we've rented places, where we've taught 15 weeks, 16 weeks, you know, where we've done these. They're like on a college level. That's the level of training. So when we do them here, what we've simply done is re-spoke them and put them up on the web to give them out 100% free. And so there's training. And again, I was a pastor for 30 years, you know, in local churches. Now I'm doing this, what I'm doing now, out on the field, you know, full-time for the last 4 years. But what I'm saying is, it is clear, and I love the body of Christ. I love my brothers and sisters in Christ, weak or strong, you know, and wounded or highly spirit-filled and doing great. I love my brothers and sisters to help them in every single way and to be blessed back, too. But the fact is, in the Akron area, I live in between Akron and Ken. Out of 550 churches, I can maybe name two that I could say, if someone calls and they're demonized, where could they be taken? There might be two churches.
It's true.
I can say, well, go to these two places. Otherwise, now that tells me that under the obedience to the Great Commission, as pastors and leaders, many of them have never been taught, and therefore they're not going to teach their people these principles. If they would, it would open their church up to experience.
Brother, yes. They're in disobedience. Some of them are ignorant, yeah. And they're perishing from lack of knowledge. And some are just in rebellion. And rebellion, folks, is the same as witchcraft. We've got witchcraft in the church. You know, Russ, I wonder if some of even the televangelists out there could be witches and warlocks that have worked their way up to the top of the organizations. We hear this term embedded witchcraft. I discuss this a lot with Rich Keltner. We think that even we have witches that have infiltrated our internet shows and are in our wall pages and are doing things like you said. They're spreading gossip and slander. They're actually doing ritual baths. They're cursing us. How far gone is the church? Would you say if you were to walk in most churches, you're probably going to find witches there?
And it's not something. It's like going to a hospital. It exists to help people, but sick people are taken there. Churches are there to do what they're supposed to be doing, but what's happened is covert infiltration has occurred.
Yes.
And so a lot of churches, they don't know how to handle this, and that's the advantage the dark side has right now, because they love to do it in stealth. That's their advantage. They love to come in unknown to do the damage, create such havoc before they ever have to leave.
I mean,
now that's part of, that's how they do it.
They operate in darkness and through deception. And folks, if you don't know about them, the better for them. They can keep on working, and they don't care. Sure. They want any advantage they have. They can have over you to take you out, to kill
right.
you if they could. And without the blood of Jesus, we're in some serious trouble, aren't we?
Absolutely. Shannon, we can go back to the old PTL thing that occurred, and I'll just mention the name, John Wesley White, and the woman that helped bring all that stuff down there. When I go back to that, I see every single ounce of the plotted, planned infiltration that occurred. That occurred among a number of big ministries in the late 70s, where the goal was to get to the top and bring, and they're trained. They are trained in compromise, reconnaissance, corruption. They're trained inside to unleash the powers, to have other groups targeting. They're coming in. Now, we also have this issue, because you mentioned about public. Okay, down in Florida a couple years ago, you have this guy. He's unleashing healings and so forth, and angels walking down, and all the stuff that's going on. Now, what I didn't, people were writing me left and right, so I started observing. Looking and observing. Okay, doctrinally, he's got some terrible teaching. Secondly, the Emma the angel thing with the bags of cash walking
Absolutely.
Down the aisle. No, now everybody's, no matter what he says supernaturally, they're all believing him.
Folks,
not everybody. I mean, there's a lot of that discerning. But
the man was demonized. People attacked others that were trying to sound the alarm. Does it have to take a man running off on his wife to get with the secretary, come on drunk on the stage, and punching people before you wake up and realize that's not God?
Right, and that's the astounding thing when I observe all this, and even what he did in the fall. Then, now, if you look at a picture of Todd Bentley prior in Canada when he was in, you see this guy with a certain haircut and everything. He looks fine.
You know, brother,
I found an email from him.
Years ago. I don't know. I got it back in 2005 or so. Or maybe it was 2003. I don't remember. But point is he looked halfway decent back then. He knew something about deliverance. And it's like he changed, didn't he?
Well, here's what I'm saying. And I have come out. And the only reason I'm saying it now is I have come out publicly. I have written to some leadership that know him directly. And I'm saying this very clearly. Todd Bentley is a multiple. He has sub-personalities that have dark powers that are highly counterfeit to the real thing. When you see him go on stage, you'll see the color of his eyes at one point, but when he starts the stuff where he goes, makes all that weird noise with his head and shakes his head, when he starts doing that, you'll see a total switch in demonized, highly trained sub-personalities take over as they begin to unleash direct counterfeit. And this is what Morningstar doesn't understand. This is where I think they don't understand. It's one thing to have a demonized person. It's nothing just to have a corrupted individual that messed up badly. But here we have someone who has sub-personalities, highly trained, programmed, demonized, that can keep it buried until the moment on stage a switch occurs. And then they begin to unleash. And then notice what the push is. Transference occurs.
Yes. Yes.
So
people walk out of there. They went in there for help. Right. Now they come out with a Kundalini demon.
Exactly. And confusion. There are lots of believers that are seeing it now. The astounding thing is that leadership, like Peter Wagner's guys, missed it. They were supposed to be at the top on spiritual warfare. Utterly missed it down there in Lakeland. Then
we have some suspicions. I've talked to Dr. Pat Holliday about it, and we even think, Peter Wagner was compromised. I honestly believe that it's so pervasive that, I look at the real deliverance ministry, then there's a false, which seems to be taking over the book stands. And you got to be very careful, my friends, who you're letting lay hands on you. They could be working for the dark side. You would never know it.
And we've seen it right in front of us occur. In a underground, what we call, they call themselves the chosen one.
Oh,
they will have sub-personality level, demon level. Now, they'll even speak in tongues. I believe that there's a real gift, but there's also a counterfeit, clear, operative counterfeit. Everyone that I've dealt with that has the counterfeit, when they do that, they transfer dark powers onto the person they're laying hands on.
Wow.
Now,
we've
had to stop it. We've had to stop them from doing it. And every single time when it's a demonic presence giving the counterfeit gifting and commanding it to come out, they lose the ability.
Brother, I don't believe that the Holy Spirit embarrasses anybody. I was raised in a Pentecostal church. Many people know this. My grandfather's ordained ministers, Church of God, Tennessee. Not the snake handlers, but Cleveland, Tennessee. My point is, as I saw the gifts of the Spirit, people being baptized in the Holy Spirit, I know it's real. I know that there's a true tongue. I get a call here about 3 months ago, brother. A guy calls in. He's a African brother. He calls in for some help. And he starts to speak, and if I didn't know, I would think that he was speaking in, heavenly tongues of the Holy Spirit. And I just started to bind it, and the next thing you know, the demon said, "No, he's ours." And turns out, folks, he had a demonic tongue. Now, I heard it firsthand, but back to the case of Mateo, I said, "What else are you doing, my friend?" He says, "We're learning how to speak in tongues." Now, here's a guy who just told me he's a warlock. And they're practicing in demonic tongues. Folks, that's why you got to discern the spirits. There's real tongues, there's a real power of God, and there's demonic tongues, and there's people that you may think that are filled with the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, and they're coming up laying hands on you to pray for you, and they're a witch. And brother, when you said they're speaking, are they doing some kind of incantation, kind of calling down the demons?
Yeah. Brother, sure. They call it twilight language. In the ancient rituals, it's languages like Beltashari, Oguam, old Pictish, old languages that are dead now, but also demonically inspired language.
Wow.
That's very, it might sound like the gift of glossolalia, the gift of languages the Holy Spirit gives real believers, but we got to understand, the Spirit of God in 2 Thessalonians 2 said, in accordance with the work of Satan and the rise of the coming, man of lawlessness, the Antichrist, he's operative in counterfeit, pseudo signs, wonders, miracles. What we need to understand, we don't need to back away from God's power, God's grace, God's might. We need to live in all of that, but we need to, like Nehemiah, on the one hand, we're building, the other hand has a sword. We have to have warfare and discernment and alertness to, when we feel in a service, someone doing something, like, or even, it could be prophecy, it could be any kind of gifting that is counterfeited. But if it's the dark side coming through, confusion will come. A real believer with the Holy Spirit will feel a check. And here's what I would say. If you literally feel a check from the Holy Spirit, that means check it out. Target it. Pray over it. Say, "Lord, okay, I see something here. Doesn't sound right. Doesn't look right. Show me." Start praying. "Jesus, expose this. Break whatever's going on here." And there's
Amen.
Times that has been done. It's been
Amen.
Done to where the person you're praying for that you're seeing using something strange turns around and looks at you.
Wow.
And it's happened. And the demonic entity looks, and you have to engage that. And so we have to. We need to in our churches today
Brother,
in the midst of worship and all that we're doing, unleash this level of authority and warfare.
That's where I want to go now, folks. If you're just tuning in, we've got Russ Dizdar, Shatter the Darkness. Is that .org, brother?
.net.
.net, shatterthedarkness.net. How do we shut down witchcraft? I mean, so we've established that covens are real, witchcraft is real, what their ultimate goal is, okay, to destroy us. They're coming in with accursed objects. They send in sexual assassins that work their way up. They seduce the pastor. My grandfather always told me one thing, Russ. He said, "When you, if you're ever in the ministry and you're counseling, always leave the door open to your office. And if you're a man of God counseling with a lady there at the church, always bring in another sister. Don't ever," you know, he said, "Satan will take you down as a man with sex, power, money, you know, lust for money. If you can sidestep those, you can probably be in the ministry a long time." And look what happened to Jimmy Swaggart. Okay? Mm-hmm. You know, he got taken down. Jim Baker got taken down. Many of these people we knew in the family. My father was in the media business for 30 years until he passed and went home in 2007. You know, he sat across, handled the media accounts of many of these people. I mean, I was raised, would sit across the table from Lester Sumrall. We know things that were going on in the churches. And, you know, I believe a lot of these people started out good. They got up there and money corrupted them. They didn't travel with their wife, maybe. They got out there and they took a personal assist. Next thing you know, they're having sex in the hotel rooms and they fall into adultery. I mean, look at what happened with Daystar, folks. How much of a shame is that? A Christian network, he's a Church of God, by the way, Marcus Lamb, preached the wedding of my aunt. And he's here, you know, it's coming out that committing adultery. They went to Dr. Phil, okay, for counseling. God have mercy. My point is folks, it's terrible. We've got divorce in the church. We've got abortions in the church. We've got people that have been compromised for money. They won't preach the truth because they're afraid the churches would split. You know where their hearts are. My point is we know that witchcraft is behind a lot of this, brother. And how do we turn the tables on the enemy? How do we shut down a coven? I know that they're organized. Okay, they train and they infiltrate churches. But how do we dry them up? Is it through their finances? What can we do to target them for a change and go through and shut them down city by city, region by region? Is there anything we can do?
Let me say, Shannon, thank you for asking the question, because this is a massive, you know, issue for me. The most important series of training we're doing right now is called Dark Rituals, Dark Presence, or Dark Rituals, Dark Powers, and it's all about this coven issue and how to detect it in your area, how to begin to go after it in your area, because here's what we learned years and years and years ago. A law enforcement agent brings me this highly demonized individual out of state. We deal with stuff. We begin to learn what they're doing, inwardly sending powers, doing things, giving demonized objects, that kind of stuff. Okay, so all of a sudden God brings my mind to Timothy chapter 2. There's a Greek word, desis. When it says pray, there's general prayers, but then desis means specific targeted prayer. So I learned that principle after this individual left. They gave information about their coven, what they're doing, when they're going to meet. So for 3 weeks, I wrote that information down on a piece of paper, and I began to thunder prayers targeting every ounce of that information. 3 weeks later, the cop brings this person back. The moment they get out of the car, they come roaring at me, literally roaring at me. What have you been doing, your spiritual warfare stuff? I didn't answer. I just smiled, and I said, why? And they looked at me, and they said, because for 3 weeks, we could hardly barely summon a demon. That took me into, that was back in the early 90s.
Wow.
That took me into this concept of, you know, targeted warfare prayer back. They know it. They understand it. They have a grid map of Northeast Ohio. Every church is listed on it. They're color-coded.
Uh-oh.
That's how specific they are.
You mean they're actually, they're sending out curses and doing rituals? Brother, what about Psalms 109? Let them that curse, love cursing, heap it on their own head. Can we return witchcraft right back to them and shut them down?
Sure, and I think this is important. I would say, number one, let's become knowledgeable biblically and what's going on contemporarily right now with all this going on. And let me say again, and I want to emphasize, 90% of it, what you and I are talking about, this tip of the iceberg. The bulk of all of what's going on is underneath this supernatural satanic secrecy, just like Ezekiel 8. So how do you get to that? Well, in your area, here's what we do here. And we found this in 50 cities. We can go to places in these reap trips that we do. This is why we do it. We begin to thunder the prayers in those areas where we've heard something's going on, praying for exposure, praying that God providentially lead us to any victims, all the stuff. But if we're asking God and constantly praying, Lord, if there, like in my city, if there's a coven that is really, it's like the hot oven, they're open, that's where the real big doors. If you feel dark power over your city, here's one of the reasons why. When they summon a demon or demons, they do it to receive power for themselves, transfer it unto others, cover their coven, fourthly, to attack Christians and attack churches and target, and the fifth level, send them into the air for manifest dark presence. How many times have we heard, wow, my city is oppressed. You can feel it in the air over my city. You can feel the oppression on this side of the city. Because that's what they've been doing for over 40 years in these darker Ezekiel 8 type of covens.
Brother,
we're
taking calls.
They know they're
from people that are wanting to commit suicide. They're looking for ways to end their life. You know, it's like, what's going on here? They're under demonic attack. Could witchcraft be involved? They're sending these spirits of suicide and depression to attack Christians also?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That could happen otherwise, too. But, I mean, for example, go to a psych ward, there's a demonized person, they put them on Thorazine or whatever, which doesn't get rid of the demon. But that demonic presence there can actually begin to affect someone else. Just like, this is what, we're believers, we should understand Ephesians 6 says, you know, to lift up the shield of faith so you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. There's a cinder, there's an arrow coming your way. What is it? It is involuntary thoughts or feelings that are contrary to God, the Word of God, the will of God. All of a sudden, a Christian feels, I don't feel like going to church. I don't want to read. I don't feel like reading my Bible. Oh, I feel oppressed. I feel depressed. I feel like, I feel like committing suicide. I don't know why I get these thoughts. They're all of a sudden just coming to my head. I feel like committing suicide. You know what? There's a sender and there's a sending. And once we can step back and say, you know what? This is coming from the outside in.
Amen. They're under demonic attack.
Exactly. A covenant can target you and say, send a demon after you with that assignment.
Okay. Folks, it's on now. We've got to attack the enemy or we're going to perish for sitting and doing nothing. You can't bury your head in the sand with Satan. He'll come up and get you from the backside. The point is, brother, it's getting really bad. We got people that are being raped by demons. We got people that, for no apparent reason, they want to commit suicide. They're depressed, just as you mentioned. I believe that people are being cursed. I tell you what I've started to do, Russ, and I want you to help me with this if I need to modify it in any way. I never know who is out there cursing me, and I know the power of the spoken tongue. Okay, so even Christians will curse people unknowingly sometimes.
Right.
There's life and death is in the power of the tongue. So what I do is I get up and I say, I cover myself with the blood of Jesus. I apply the blood of Jesus to my home, to my car, my kids, my family. And I break every hex, vex, curse, spell, hoodoo, voodoo, witchcraft, Santeria ritual, any kind of psychic prayer. I break and cut any demonic attack being sent against me off of me. And I send it back to where it came from, sevenfold in Jesus' name. Now, praying that, did that help me at all?
Absolutely, yes. It's preemptive. You're doing preemptive prayer. You're doing what it says in Colossians 4:2, where God says, be devoted to prayer. And then there's that word, be watchful. Look it up in the Greek. Here's what it says. The Greek word means looking for the impending danger. Well, that's only coming from the enemy. In the context of warfare, because Epaphras was struggling in prayer, warfaring in prayer for them. So that's a warfare issue. Be devoted to prayer, but being watchful. Okay, so look at the disciples. Here's what I believe Jesus does. What you've done is what every believer should be trained to do and know how to clear the air in the morning. And the great thing is opening the day in God's presence in prayer, the Word, and praying for lost souls, unleashing intercession. Well, then, it's a normal thing for me, warfare. I will say in the midst of my time,
that's what I want
and it's
to
just
know.
A normal thing.
Man,
yeah,
what
I'll say this. I'll say, what's What's going on, Lord? What? Give me a heads up. Just like when Jesus there was in the supper, he said, Simon, Simon, Satan has just asked to sift you all as wheat.
Yes.
It's plural in the Greek. Sift all of you guys. But I pray for you that all of you guys' faith will not fail. Well, eventually, all of them were struck, scattered. Peter was so agitated and annoyed and fear-filled that he denied Jesus three times and cussed about it. And he had no idea what hit him. Now, later on, guess what? Look at Peter in Acts chapter 5. When Satan literally fills, same Greek word for being filled with the Spirit, he fills Ananias and Sapphira to try to infiltrate the church. But now Peter, in the power of the Holy Spirit, discerns this, stops this, and it stops at the door. So I do this in the morning. Lord, after I do like you just said, you cover things that you know. You cover things you know of a covenant over here or people you're dealing with or someone says they do this or somebody sends you a thing or puts a dead, you know, thing on your porch. Well, then you know what to do. But what about, because they love to do it covertly. So
yes.
I just simply say, because we have the Holy Spirit in us. Who greater? This is the God, the Holy Spirit, omniscient. That he knows everything. He knows everything all that's going on. So I'm just saying, Lord, you know, what's going on? Give me a heads up. Is there anything being sent my way that I need to know? Do I need to pray against anything, preempt anything, ask you to cut things off? And there'll be times where you got to listen to the Lord. You got to get a discernment to say, and the Lord gives you a heads up. And you can strike that ahead of time.
Okay.
If you know of a covenant sending something, you can strike, you can command, you can pray. We've prayed, at times we prayed, Lord, put this on their own head. Other times I've prayed, Lord, invade their lives like you did the king in Daniel's day with a dream that brought him to such disturbing, he was so bugged by it, he had to get an answer. And only God, this is where God was breaking into a demon, you know, that whole kingdom. So can I pray, God, invade these, you know, witches and Satanists and heavy-duty folks, invade them that way, or engage them like Saul of Tarshish. Look how God brought down Saul of Tarshish. We have incredible power, but here's Shannon, here's what, I've been out among churches. I belong to what I believe is a good church right now, but I'm not pastoring anymore, so I can't lead them like I used to in 25, 30 minutes of intercession and prayer right in the service, right as we go into worship. That's what I did. That's what I trained the folks to, you know, be a part of. And it was a powerful, you know, we were into prayer and worship. That lasted an hour before we ever got to the Word of God. But here's what I've done in the last couple of years. We're out looking for churches, praying where to go. Here's the average. The average amount of prayer in the local Sunday morning service, this is my experience, 58 seconds.
Wow.
The entire congregation gathers. They'll have an opening prayer. They'll do a prayer over here, a prayer over the offering, a closing prayer. So, and I just kind of was doing this to kind of see, because it is such an evidence of the suppression of the dark side against us. And again, I think we're not obeying 2 Timothy, where the Holy Spirit says, first of all, and with urgency, put up the prayers, intercessions, in this massive barrage. It should be a house of prayer. So I think that if you and I as individuals can get up, worship the Lord, bless the Lord, get the Word of God, feed, build ourselves up in our most holy faith, and then in that context of prayer, intercession for the lost and other people and things and asking God to stretch his hand out and minister here or there, in that context, then I go into, Lord, what's going on? And that's what I'm going to do. What you just said is excellent. To cut off anything that's coming, ask the Lord, Lord, you know what anybody's doing. We're asking you to break everything that's being sent against us.
Amen.
Engage these people. You know, I do. I pray for their salvation, but I also pray because when they, like I got a letter in the mail, and it has a picture of a hooded man, all hand-drawn, hand-colored, slicing open the baby, the blood, you know, falling off the baby, and on to the right it says, this blood is for you. Now I get this, and again, it burns my britches. I'm bugged with it. Well, then this ancient brotherhooder, Satanist, comes in a couple days later. I bring it out. I said, this is from your guys' group, isn't it? They agree. They said, yes. I said, what's this all about? They said, on that big ritual night, they sacrificed a child on behalf of you, on behalf of you, Russ, and sending stuff against you. So listen, I have done this. Lord, whatever it takes. If they're going to be sexually traumatizing and brutalizing a 12-year-old girl, or if they're going to be cutting up a 6-year-old little kid, whatever it takes, you're the God that brought down Pharaoh. You're the God that brought down Herod in the book of Acts. One angel, one sword, brought down Herod. Whatever it takes, Lord, on that basis, I ask you to stop them.
Amen. Folks, we're not cursing them. Russ, if someone sent me a box and it had a rattlesnake in there, and I said, hey, where's this from? I don't recognize this person sent it to me. And I feel, I hear something shaking, then I realize what it is. I don't have an obligation to open that thing. In fact, what you can do with the mail, just put on there, return to sender. I send back. Folks, people say, but you're cursing them when you send back. No, I'm not cursing them because I didn't originate it. All I'm saying here is if they want to send it to me to try to kill me, to try to destroy me, I have no obligation to receive that. I send it back to where it came from. I say, here, you take it back. I don't want that. And Psalms 109 is a warfare prayer that allows you to do just that. Let them that love cursing, let them heap it on their own head. There's other stuff there. But, of course, at the same time, I think it's good to say, Father God, I ask that you would bless them. I ask that you'd loose the Holy Spirit to convict them of their sin. In fact, I loose the spirits of adoption and salvation to them in Jesus' name. God, give them a vision of hell. Let them see the truth. Save their soul at any cost in Jesus' name.
Sure.
Now, let me ask you this question. Let's say you are able to target and locate a witch's coven. You know where they're physically located, and you know what they're up to. Can we use the keys of the kingdom Jesus gave us to shut them down, binding and loosing? Whatever we bind on earth is bound in heaven. So I don't know if this works, but I wanted to run it by you. What if we were to say, okay, I know, for example, over in Salem, Massachusetts, the chief witch over there, I think her name is Lori Cabot. Cabot. And a really wicked woman. Very beautiful one time. You look at what she is now, folks. That's what Satan does to you. He'll age you really fast. And he'll take you like a tin can, crush you, drink you, then throw you away. So, I got angry one time at what's going on over there. I heard that, at least 1 in 10 over there are witches. Maybe more. So I said, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I bind the strong man operating over that coven and every individual there, all the witches and warlocks. I bind the unclean spirits in them in Jesus' name. I loose the angels of God to go down there and start attacking those foul spirits in Jesus Christ's name. And I cover that whole coven with the blood of Jesus. And I command any curse that's being sent out of there to go back on their heads in Jesus' name. And I bind their finances in the name of Jesus. I heard one guy say that he would bind their finances and loose the spirit of poverty to attack them, to shut down their finances, and when they dried up for lack of money, they went out of business. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think that, and I do. I think, listen, in spiritual warfare, in that level, I call it ritual warfare at that level, because what we need to understand, and this is where they know, and they are constantly, every week, sometimes 2-3 times a week, they're doing large and or small rituals to summon demons, get more and more and more. We have no concept of how many. So, yes, 3 things that I'm praying. 1, God visit them the way you did that king in Daniel's day in such a way that they're so disturbed, give them no rest over this, that ultimately it brings them down to their knees to confess that you are God. Secondly, with that is, Lord, engage him like you would Saul of Tarsus. You look how this guy that was attacking the church and had a Stephen, he was, whatever, I do pray, number one, God save them. God's not willing anybody perish.
Amen.
So I'm praying that. That's the top tier. Then with that, though, I'm saying, because I know, I have seen the slides, I've picked up the pieces, we've been to the sites, I've sat with the dad, that 14-year-old daughter was stolen, slaughtered, left in the field, her bones there. I've seen so much of this pain and destruction, so I have to include now on a third level saying, Lord, I am now going to target them, praying every power broken, every demon present broken, visit the priests, visit the individuals, you know. And there's times we've said exactly that. Lord, what they have sent, what they have done, what they have summoned, put it back on their own heads. And then fourthly, one other thing I include sometimes, Shen, is this. When I know it brings, when I know it's to the level of that level of sexual, physical, or even blood, you know, sacrifice,
yes,
I will say, God, what we've done and what we've prayed at this point, whatever it takes. I'm telling a true story. This is absolutely true. We had 8 victims of one individual guy, Satanist. We tried to get to him. We tried to engage him. We tried. He kidnapped a guy. We had to go through the feds. We had to do what we needed to do to get this kid back and out from him. He decimated this kid sexually, demon-wise. He had everything. So when we did this deliverance and this person confessed that this guy, his name was, I won't give his last name, Dan, that he actually sexually brutalized a 12-year-old and did a ritual to make demons come in and then kill her and to get the demons for himself, we prayed, God, whatever it takes, I'm asking you, stop him. We have so many victims, Lord. Look what's happened. If this occurred, stop him. This is true. I can get the OB. I'm telling the truth. This Dan, he was on Christian television. He was in churches. He could play Amazing Grace, but behind the scenes, he was one of those people. I'm talking about the infiltrators. He was doing horrific. So in 10 days, he dies of a strange illness.
Wow.
He's gone. Well, now people have come forward out of Lisbon and Salem, Ohio. Now the estimates from a counselor is 100 or more other victims that are now willing to come forward and say what he did. That's how vile he was, how arrogant like King Herod. So when there's arrogance and vile like that, and we say, God, we do pray the destruction of demons, destruction of the networks, destruction of the dark side. Jesus came to destroy the dark side. But whatever it takes, here's what we actually seen. Just like in the book of Acts, I think just like in the Old Testament times, God stepped in, but only because there was intervention prayer-wise. If we could have caught them, that would have been a different thing. You know, we'd have nailed them. We would have done anything to drag them, you know, on a law enforcement level. You know, that would have been, you know, one way of stopping him hurting people. But I believe God took him down. There's, for Christians, we understand there's a sin and a death. But in the book of Acts, God brought down by sending one angel. He touched King Herod, and Josephus, the non-Christian historian, writes that Herod, in 5 days, filled up with maggots and died.
Yes.
Now that's what the book of Acts is talking about. Now I'm not asking God, like, all, just kill this person. That we don't do. We're highly careful on how we train people on this area. But in that tiered system of praying that God will visit them in a supernatural way, God will engage them like Saul of Tarshish and save them. That's ultimately the desire. But then break every power, break everything, ask God to put it on their heads to disturb them and let it come down on them and let them know that God has brought this on their heads for what they have done and they're experiencing and that they'll never want to do it again.
Amen.
But further than that, God, if they're arrogant, if they're going to destroy a child, I would ask you to stop them, whatever it takes. And I'm saying we have literally, I believe without question, God brought that person, arrogant, unrepentant, heinous person down.
Brother, there's no question about it.
It took him out.
There's no question about it. God intervenes, folks. And you know what? That's a terrible thing, is to fall in the hands of an angry God. You know what? We don't want these people to die and go to hell. You know what? I took the time to warn some witches recently that I'm one Christian that knows how to do spiritual self-defense, and I'm not going to sit and take the attacks. Time's already too short. If they want to attack me, it's going to go back on their head, so don't even bother. Some people got angry. Well, you know, you're not showing love. No, I'm showing love because I know the power and authority the Lord Jesus Christ has given you and I, Russ, and the believers out there that are called by Jesus' name, okay, will humble themselves and pray and get in the Word of God, and use the weapons he's given us, because we've been given authority over all the works of the enemy to tread on serpents and scorpions. And we've been told to stand in the gap for the innocent. Folks, we've got to do it. If we don't do it, who's going to do it? Russ told you the truth. He said he probably couldn't count on his hand maybe two churches that he could recommend people up in the area there where they could go and get some deliverance. Most churches don't want to talk about it. They said, you know, that's not for me. That'll offend people. That's giving Satan too much attention. Or, you know what, I don't believe in demons, can be in a Christian, go take some psychotropic drugs. Folks, it's horrible. The harvest is white, the fields are white, and there's very few people that want to talk about what Russ has been dealing with for the last 30 years. But it's a reality, and whether you like it or not, you're going to come face to face with it, so you better learn how to do some defense now. Because we're in the Super Bowl of the end times, and evil is ramping up. And so, you know, I put these witches on notice, Russ, and I said, hey, don't even bother to curse because it's going to go back on your head. We'll shut you down in the name of Jesus Christ. But you know what? Beyond that, we do want to see some witches come to Christ. You know, there's nothing greater that I would love to have happen than we see one, a high-ranking witch, warlock, Satanist, come out of the occult and then expose and give up the information. You know, I've known a couple people that claim to have left the dark side, but I always suspect that it's not like they said. They haven't totally given up their old ways because you ask them for information and they don't want to give you any nitty-gritty. They're just tight-lipped. I'm like this. If God has delivered you out of the clutches of Satan and the road to hell, don't you want to turn the tables on the enemy and give up information that can be used against the enemy, folks? So if you have come out of the occult, you don't need to fear anything but the Lord. You know, you need to give up the information that we can use to turn the tables. You know, where are these covens located? How are they operating? You know, what's their plans? That's why we interrogate many times demonic spirits when they manifest. You know, some people say, put a gag in their mouth. Well, you know, brother, I don't know sometimes what was the gateway that the demons came in. And we found demons that came in because family were involved in witchcraft. They've got a generational curse. They need to repent of it, break it. And, you know, if you don't allow the demons to speak, folks, sometimes you can't get that information. You might get a few out, but other ones aren't coming out if they've got a legal right. So I believe you should interrogate the enemy. But I said all that to say this. Yeah, I want to see people come to Christ and be spared, but we mean business, folks. We've went past the point where we can, you know, sit on the pews and think that the enemy will pass us by if we ignore him. No, he's coming after you. He's coming after your kids. We know of one case, Russ, where a child went to a summer camp last year. She came home and she was so demonized, she was trying to bite her toes off and take chunks out of arms. They took her to a hospital and they gave her every high-powered drug they could as a sedative, and it still didn't work. And some brothers went in and they started to rebuke it in the name of Jesus, and the thing started to almost levitate the girl off the ground. It turns out she had been playing with the Ouija board at summer camp, at a Christian summer camp. Somebody had put it in their bag. Folks, this stuff is horrible. It's taking casualties. I have a friend, brother, that a spirit of suicide jumped on him. He blew his brains out 3 weeks ago with a shotgun. I'm talking a doctor, a very intelligent man. He had lost all hope. We get calls every day. Folks, these spirits want to kill you. They want to steal from you, and they want to destroy you and your family. They want to cause you to go into divorce. They want you to cause your kids to be estranged and get off into witchcraft and drugs and fornication. You know, the enemy's taking no prisoners. That's why we're talking about these things tonight. How can we turn the tables on the enemy? Let me ask you a question, Russ. I hear the term scanning done by witches and astral projection. What's actually going on there? Will a smart witch, before they try to launch an attack, go down and try to see who they're dealing with? What is meant by that term, scanning?
Yeah, sure. They're reading, in a sense. In astral projection, that's another advanced level of warfare on their part in projecting out, empowered by the demonic presence. Now, we have in the Bible where, you know, Paul went out of the body by the Holy Spirit, or John, he went out by the Spirit of God and what God wanted to show them. On the opposite side of the fence, there's the ability by demonic empowerment to get up out of your body, and for them, they want to go find, you know, observe, do recon, look, observe, and sometimes unleash something right then and there.
Could you be sleeping in your bed, as some people are saying, and they're, you know, they feel an attack, you know, paralysis. Usually it's a night spirit, but like an incubus or succubus. But What about a witch? Could they astral project and come down and be looking at you in your home and come in there and try to look to see if you've got any areas of vulnerability?
Absolutely.
How
and
do you
I'm saying,
about
frankly,
that?
Absolutely. Well, again, Holy Spirit discernment, that sense where all of a sudden, and I'll just say experientially, where I've felt where it is a person that is projected by a demonic presence, that's a little different. There's a little feeling of there like someone actually is entered, a human being has actually entered your house.
Okay.
So there's a sense where there's a little, so, you know, and again, it's a learning thing. Because it doesn't happen every night, but there's times you just feel something demonic. There's times you wake up, and usually this occurs around 3 a.m., somewhere around that time, late in the middle of the night.
Is that
but
called
if
witching
they do
hour?
That,
they like to
yeah,
work around
because it's,
them, don't they?
Well, it's when they're releasing, yeah, because by that time they're releasing everything,
okay.
And they're highly charged. Yeah, and so if they come to observe or, now again, real underground Satanist brotherhooders, they understand that this, they call it blitzkrieg warfare, lightning warfare, to where they might get two or three people to do this at the same time.
Wow.
And they're trying to do, by allowing their own being to be kind of a vessel, they're letting themselves be an extended act of direct warfare against an individual. What do you do? Here's what we learn. Here's what happened. Again, this is another experience, but all I can tell you was what happened. When I experienced that a few nights, what I really felt led to do was, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command the demonic empowerment on this person doing this to be broken right now in Jesus' name. Here's what the person said a week later when they, you know, came around and we engaged them. They said, when you did that, Russ, it was like a rubber band that we were, all of a sudden it snapped and we instantly were slammed back into our body.
Wow. Now, repeat that again. What did you actually say, and what could people out there say to stop
well,
this from happening?
If you ever feel that, you know, there's an astral projection type of spiritual warfare, they can't do it without the demonic empowerment anyway.
Okay.
So I will then target the demonic presence, just like Paul did in Acts 16, the girl that had the python spirit predicting the future, that kind of stuff. And he finally got so agitated, he turned around, he said, and it says this, he addressed the spirit. He didn't say it to the woman,
yes.
He addressed the spirit. Get out. So that's what I say, target the demon. Authority in Christ is only for the demonic anyway. So target the demon. In the name of Jesus, I break your empowerment over, I take authority of you, command
okay.
you to stop this and break this in Jesus' name. But then I'll go on to pray, Lord, engage this person. You know, why they're doing this. And, of course, clear the air if they've sent anything. Lord, whatever they're sending, whatever they're trying to do, you know, and I'll ask, give me, Lord, what are they trying to do? Is it observation or is it warfare? Literally, this is I'm telling you another true story. This was a victim of satanic of ritual stuff, but he also gave in to the demonic side and started practicing. So I go to visit him one night, and he has this circle of candles. They're all melted down, and where he's been kneeling and all this. And I'm like, what's going on here? His first name is Marshall. I said, what's going on, Marshall? And 2 days prior, I'd gone to meet him down where his psychiatrist or psychologist met him, wanted me to come down and talk and wanted to meet me. So we started talking. So a few days later, I go over to this guy's house. And I said, what are you doing here? He goes, well, he says, to tell you the truth, I was astral projecting. And I
wow.
said, you were? And I said, why? And I said, why were you doing that? He said, because of that psychologist. He says, Russ, I got to her house. He described the curtains in her bedroom,
oh my
described
goodness.
Her bed. And I said, why'd you do that, Marshall? He says, to touch her sexually.
Wow.
He said, I wanted her sexually.
My goodness. When
this
people
is
a, are having...
This is...
Brother, that's horrible. But
yeah.
Let me ask you a question. A lot of people are having dreams, and they're having sexual dreams. Maybe they have an orgasm in their dream. Some people have said, you know, they've been raped and so forth. Could... I know demons will do that, like incubus and succubus, but could there be humans that are astral projecting to have their way with people as they sleep?
I have books here written by them that say they do. I have actual books here. I won't give the name because I don't want anybody buying them, but I have them here. It tells right in there how to have psychic sex, how to go to individuals, On a darker level, they'll do it as a sexual rape. They might want to do that. So you got to remember, unclean demons. Now, when a person has experienced this at night, it could be from a past sexual experience they had, a simple one, where a demon then said, hey, I have rights. I'm going to keep coming back to this person.
Could that be through a soul tie that they have with that person?
Exactly. Exactly.
Wow, so let's say you have sex with somebody outside of marriage. You know, you fornicate, or if you have adultery inside marriage, you actually become one soul with them. Does that mean that any demons that they have come up that umbilical cord and vice versa?
It really has that kind of picture to where, again, because the demons are looking for a right, a legal right. What right can I have to go after this person? What topon, what legal door? So if the doorway was, you know, sinful, I mean, let me say clear, God created sex to be a good thing. We know this. But on the other side, Satan, everything, uses things for the bad. So where there's a sinful side of it, the door can be opened for a demonic presence to come in. If the person you're having sex with has a demon spirit that transfers, and or that demonic presence, because of the person's unrepentant sin, says, hey, I have a right, I'm going to go after them. Even if I have an inch, I'm going to try to take a mile. That's their mentality. If they can get an inch, they want more, so they know where to visit. They know what to begin to do, and notice that when you're almost asleep, when you're completely defensive and passive, is when some of this occurs.
Okay,
you get that sleep paralysis.
You get the sleep paralysis. Go on, I'm sure.
You get that presence in the room, and then what happens is it's incremental. First, you feel the presence in the room, something on your bed, something on your chest, something holds you down, and then begins the sexual part of it.
Brother,
not stop this.
Yeah. Go ahead.
If a person, because I'm telling you, we've done deliverances over women. Guys have had this too. I had a professor tell me about, Shannon, this professor says, oh man, it was wild sex. You know, and he's talking about a demon.
Wow.
Now this guy got delivered, got freed from it. It was really a struggle because you know how sexual addiction can. Strong sexual addiction opens a door for deep-seated demonic attachment.
Oh my
And he
goodness.
Had a struggle. He had a real struggle. But you gotta, if you feel that, you know, something's coming on like that to you, and you know, even regardless of where it came from, if you want to say, Lord, what did I do? What order? How's this thing? Because they can't come without some level of right.
Okay.
So is this generational? Did this come from my parents? Am I in a bedroom that we bought a house from? Where all kinds of sexual perversion, sin, and ritual stuff went on, and demons are in that room because they have a right. So all of a sudden I go buy a house, and I'm in that bedroom, and all of a sudden I begin to be approached by a spirit, in this way. And all of a sudden I feel sexual. I have a dream, I experienced sex in my dream. Well, you better check out, number one, what's the doorway? Where did it come from? Ask the Lord, where is it coming from? Along with that, inseparably, Lord, I renounce this. I close any door possibility, and I ask you to, Lord, attack the demonic realm and stop this. And then if it actually is beginning to occur, then overtly pray, in the name of Jesus, stop this. Get out of here. Never. And again, you got to do this. Order them, because that's what they're legalists. Never come back. Never come back. Otherwise, they might. Go outside the house because they're real entities. They might go outside the house and they're 20 yards away and they want to wait and see if they can kind of see if you really mean it. You know, they want to come back and try it again. Well, clear the air. You know, draw the line and close the doors permanently, because the truth is this, in pastoral experience, I'm telling you the truth, there are those who allow it to happen.
I had a guy
repent of it.
Who openly said, I just asked for anything in the atmosphere to come in and have sex with me. That's what the guy said. And the next thing you know, he was being visited. He said something flew into his ear. And within about 3 days, he was having sex in his dreams. And then it went to demons were raping him, sodomizing him during the daytime. And the guy is being so sexually abused, he's having to wear... you know, things to actually protect him, guards, because these things just attack him and have their way with him all hours a day, and he's tired of it now, and he wants to stop it. So, you know, folks, if you invite these things in, they're going to come in. If you want to open the door through sin, they're going to come in. You've got to repent and shut the door, and you certainly don't invite these things in. But is there anything a person can do to, or that they should do, just like in the morning, you know, you're breaking these curses off you that could be sent. What about at night before you go to bed? Is there any regimen you go through? Because once you sleep, right? So what do you do to protect yourself before you go to bed?
Yeah, and I think one thing is already having things cleared. And again, if I'm going to go to bed and I feel like something's up, well, you might as well take care of it. Because if you go to bed and you don't take care of it, you're not going to get a lot of good sleep. You're going to have to get up at some point and take care of something.
Can you loose the angels of God to surround your home, for example, in Jesus' name, protection?
Yeah, I will say it this way, though. I'll say, Lord, Psalm 68 says, the chariots of God are tens of thousands and thousands upon thousands. Lord, just absolutely guard this area, protect this area. And here's what we need to know. God wills to protect. God wills to do Psalm 91. But I think there's times that because, again, in ritual format, both in lesser and darker areas, in Kralinian magic, things like that, the goal would be, for example, if there's someone that saw you and said, I'm going to conjure spirits to send them towards Shannon to elicit him lustfully to want me and draw him to me so that we can have, or a person that knows how to do astral projection, they might come to try to engage. Now, that's pretty heavy.
Brother,
so you got to hit it back heavy.
That's heavy. So what could be the point of contact? You know, I'm up on Facebook, for example. You know, I don't know who half the people are sometimes that you add as friends. And I know witches are real, and we think that we've even got some embedded ones that are causing strife, you know, undercover. But is it dangerous to have even a photograph up on your page? Can that be enough?
I'll make it very clear that there's a lot of things like that, yeah, but here's number one. I believe at this point more than ever that we need to realize how much authority, how much God gives protection, how massive the spiritual power presence and might is on our side of the fence.
Yes.
It shouldn't be me who lives in fear. It should be the other side. In the Old Testament, when the terror of the Lord came on demonized camps, they melted in fear.
Praise God. When
the terror of the Lord came. So what I need to do is become aggressive. In this day, when the greatest ramping up of dark manifestation has occurred, and it will only get darker in the broadest, Jesus said of the days coming, there's no, you can't look over your shoulder to the past to equate it. It's so broader, it's so darker, it's so horrific of the demonic side's manifestation. It's unprecedented. So, not only do we need to know biblically, you know, soul winning and sharing and praying and worshiping and warfare. That's normal. To me, what we're talking about, Shannon, to me, is normal biblical discipleship living. What you're saying that you do in your prayers, that we're living. Look at Daniel three times a day. He lived in Babylon, 56 temples, demonic temples. You realize now why he probably had three times a day. He was clearing the air. He was guarding himself, let alone unleashing prayer for God to come in and engage the king.
He was surrounded by it. He had to do that just to survive, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
And, you know, and just the same with you out there and listening tonight, folks, we've got to actually be aggressive against the enemy. He's asked, you know, he doesn't want to give you and I mercy. We don't need to show Satan any mercy. And so that's one thing I've been doing. I've been also, you know, I cover my property with the blood of Jesus. I asked God to put a wall of fire around, like Zechariah 2 and 5. I heard a sister bring that out, that one time she was in Africa, asked God to put a wall of fire, a hedge of protection, Zechariah 2 and 5 around her, and a witch was actually walking to the compound and was going to try to break in and you know, basically take her life that night. Hit that wall of fire, Russ. They found her dead the next day. Her body had been barbecued.
Yeah.
This stuff is real, folks. You know, we don't want to see that happen, but that's why we warn them. If you want to try it, that's going to be what happens. What about cutting silver cords? Has there ever been a time that has been necessary? You mentioned that when the people that they came after you, you know, basically they were snapped back in their body. Now, the word says, lest the silver cord's ever been broken. What happens if that silver cord got cut? I mean, I heard a guy, let me put it like this. Guy told me he's from Africa. He believes in deliverance. He's a Christian. He said in certain cities over there, you would go over there, and after a weekend, you would find naked, dead bodies laying on the ground. I said, well, what the heck's that? He said, that's people that were astral projecting, and they didn't make it back to their body. Now, you know, seeing is believing, but, I mean, you think that's a true story? Is it possible that you're astral projecting, you don't make it back if your cord got cut?
I'd say absolutely yes. One of the experiences that back when I was into that Golden Buddha and back with this master, this is an actual story. Everybody in Barberton knows this, and I'm not going to use his name because he was known from Taiwan, powerful in martial arts, powerful in powers, though. He would go off an astral project to go to Shambhala. What happened was he didn't return.
Wow.
The other masters there in Barberton got around. They were trying to do all kinds of stuff to bring him back. Physically, the body died. He never returned. This is a true story right here. Now, that's the guy that was teaching me in the temple about how to get to the, you know, ascended masters. He never returned. Here's the other story. A person comes in out of the ancient brotherhood, very dark. That's the darkest of the dark occultism. And they tell me, because we were going through this big battle warfare-wise, we're out in the fields, we're out all over the place, and military individuals were involved from the Monarch Project, stuff like that. And here's what she says. She says, Russ, because when we went through this deliverance thing and cut off everything and prayed, one of the individuals, they said they triangulated when they left their bodies, demonized, of course, to come and do they called it psychic attack or psychic assassination, they called it. And they said, what happened, Russ, is that the one guy got cut off and his physical body died. Now, I didn't see the body. I'm just reporting what I was told. But I never had any other conflict or connection, or we never had that, you know, anything about that person ever showing up again. I do believe that if a person gets out of the body, and here's the big warning to Stargate remote viewers, thousands of new remote viewers,
yes.
Military remote viewers,
yes.
That's the same. It's a sanitized version of the same thing, because they know their energies, non-human enhancement enables them to get the revelate the data and do what they're doing and to go places and to get the information. And I just had a remote viewer on that got out of it, knew that it was wrong, knew that it was dark side presence, knew that in the practice of it, the spirit walked right up to his back to engage and grab him from the back while he was starting this passive practice. So, yeah, I believe that they can be cut off.
They're basically just astral projecting, aren't they?
Yeah.
Remote viewing?
Yeah, they don't like to call it that, but in the real sense, here's how it works. In astral projection, where the Satanists or whoever is doing it knows what they're doing, by the powers that are in them, they go up and out. They can call it the astral plane. My master, the guy that called it the great universal, the remote viewers will call it the ether. I think it's the second heavenlies, where that actual demonic, you know, realm is. Now, here's the issue. When they go out, where are they going into? Ephesians 2 says, the prince of the power of the eros, the Greek word eros, air. Eros means the immediate dense atmosphere here on the earth. They are literally between two realms. They can see and try to bring effect against us, but they're actually in that realm. But by the demonic manifestation, they're able to kind of be in both realms in a way. They're in deep danger. With a remote viewer, a military remote viewer out of Fort Bragg, when they said they had this ability, they called me, they told me the color of my house, the white column, they were telling me all this stuff. So we get together, and I said, well, how did you learn this? Well, I had a curiosity. I started reading books. Then I felt this energy. Then I started doing it. Then the energy got stronger. So I said, well, let's pray about that energy. In the name of Jesus Christ, we command that this be exposed. What is this, Lord?
all of a sudden they say, Russ, it's a translucent spirit. This is the one that's been here. In the name of Jesus, who are you? The spirit answers, Argon.
Wow.
So we go through this battle a little bit, and all of a sudden I said, I bind you, I command you, you're not going to go anywhere. The demon begins, you know, this argon. To them, they're seeing, they said it looks like a beautiful new age translucent spirit. That's what's been emanating and giving me energy to do this. And they didn't want to give it up. And so all of a sudden I command, in the name of Jesus, I bind you, argon, you will not go anywhere. Right now, I command you, under the authority of the living Christ, tell this person your ultimate goal. And this demon, Argon, screamed out to take them to blankety-blank hell.
God have mercy.
Well, then the person's like, all right, get it out. So in the name of Jesus, we commanded Argon to leave. When Argon left, when this presence left, they could not do it anymore.
God have mercy. When you cast out a demon, do you just tell them to come out, or do you send them to certain locations, like send them to the pit or Tartarus or hell or dry places? What has been your experience? What do you typically do?
In really bad heavy duty cases, and when I feel the Holy Spirit's, the idea of permission, and I will say, go to the abyss. Please understand, every demon, I mean, they all know what the abyss is.
They don't like that.
Even in the scriptures, they don't like it, no. They're very angry. There's times when manifestation occurs, you command, get out and don't come back. There's times that occurs a lot, just like Jesus. He used the word ek in the Greek, meaning a command, a stern command to get out. So sometimes it is just get out, but there's times where you feel such evil and uncleanness, and you feel a leading where, I've said two things. I've said, in the name of Jesus, and I'll say, Lord, you know what to do with this. I'll say, in the name of Jesus, I command you, wherever Jesus tells you to get out and go, now, leave, get out.
Absolutely.
On the other hand, it has happened, and I can't say every single case, but on the other hand, I've said, because they're really struggling to hold on, the demonic power is really vicious, really vulgar,
yeah,
and very powerful, and I'll say, in the name of Jesus, collect the other demons that are there with you. And I'll do this sometimes. What I'll do first of all, Shannon, I'll say, and I know that I'm going to say to the demon, how many are there. But before I say that, and a lot of times I have a pencil and pad next to me, I'm already saying, Lord, how many's there? I want to listen to what God says first. And if the Lord says 47, and then I command, in the name of Jesus, how many are there? And the demon, you can even tell sometimes. They got personality. You can even tell, there's 13. They'll say, and I'll say, you're lying. And you are. There's 47. And then they're shocked. And then you just, you command, and there's, whenever I've done that, though, they're angry, violent, they're screechy, they are, and when they go out, it is a big deal. And I do believe they go to the abyss, they're locked down, and they're not going to operate until that thing is opened up later on.
You have any advice on how to rout out the strong man and kick him out? I know a lot of times he'll sacrifice some of his underlings, and he'll be the last that wants to go out. But any advice on how to route these things?
Yeah, whenever like you do, there's more, usually more than one.
Yeah.
Richly abused people and others that might have 30, 40, 50, 60, 100, whatever, instead of dealing with this one, that one, this one, that one, this one, that one, what I will do is, and what we've learned to do, because we spend 8 hours, we won't do that any longer. I won't spend 8 hours doing this. We will now come down, and it's an hour, we'll command the ruling spirit. I'll just say, whatever demon comes up, I command in the name of Jesus, who is the ruling, who is the head over this? Because if you got 30 there, there's always a head. There's always one. They're in ranked.
Yes.
So you look for the ruling one, deal with the rule, and they're usually the strongest and most arrogant of them. And that's the one you deal with. And when you get ready to kick that one out, you command that all the demons he's over, all the demons he's brought in, all of them collectively get together. And if it is 47 of them, all of you, and I command that you take all of those you brought with you and every demon that's here right now, and all of you go as a group. commanding the head one out, like Legion. He commanded Legion to get out, but all, and there may have been, if Legion meant, you know, Roman 144,000, there may have been that many. There's
absolutely
no spatiality in this. Yeah, there could be many, because they don't, you know, it's not a matter of room like physicality. They're able to do this. Whereas we would have God the Holy Spirit because he's infinite. We don't need more spirits. They do. We have God the Holy Spirit. And this is massive in comparison. Every
Amen.
Demon is just finite and limited. That's why they like to collect. And that's why they like to group together. The more of them, the pack, as you call it, the stronger, the more grip. But go for the head dog and command for the ruling one. And that might take a little bit sometimes. But
yeah,
to get
some
to
of
the
them,
ruling one.
And kick him out and have bind him to the rest, right? Make him take those with him?
Exactly.
What
and
what do you do when you get a stubborn demon and, you know, he's tight-lipped? And have you found any techniques for getting them to manifest and speak? A lot of them, you know, want to, like I was praying with one person and they immediately went possum and put the person to sleep. You know, they don't want to manifest. They want to hide. Any tips on how to get them to manifest or give up the name of a strong man if they're being reluctant?
Well, one thing I would say to rely on is, since the Holy Spirit, there's no demon can hide from the Holy Spirit. Psalm 139, where can I flee from your presence? You know, or Daniel's prayer in Daniel chapter 2, that God knows, you know, what dwells in darkness. So I already assume the Holy Spirit knows exactly how many, what they are, who they are, everything, you know. So I'm going to say inwardly, that's what I want to do. And demons, they're shocked when you know before you have to draw it, you know, because they're expecting you to have to draw it out of them. So I want to ask, first of all, and I love working with teams, too, good people next to me that are also gifted in areas and can get a discernment. And I love teams because that gives us even more abilities. But many times you just got to do it. So I'm asking the Lord, you know, Lord, is there a name of a demon that I need to call them? Looking for Holy Spirit strategy in heavy-duty demonization is important. To be able to get to who you need to get to. Now, when you come to ritually abused, where there's really fragmented personality, and then you've got a structure that's even harder, but not impossible, to get to the demonic and ask God then to bring inner healing, so that doorways are closed and no accesses are given.
Amen. I like that. Close the doorways. Ask God to bring restoration of the mind, inner healing. When you're actually doing the deliverance, and let's say a spirit manifests and it takes on the characteristics of an animal, have you come up with any rationale as to why there seems to be some differences in some of these spirits? I mean, in other words, I've heard some say that all of them are the fallen angels that fell with Lucifer. But then there's others that they're the fallen angels, but then the demons are actually the offspring of the Genesis 6 giants that mated with the women, and all those half-giant, half-women that died in the flood, their spirits are the demons. And then, you know, you hear about the giants were mating with animals, and maybe they produce chimera. What's your take on that? Are demons different than the fallen angels? Are they one and the same? Are there different classes? You know, why
I
are
would
some...
say in my research, yeah, you're right. They're different. That's a good word to use. Jesus said in Mark's gospel, in dealing with the one thing, is this, when he says this kind comes out by prayer and fasting, the word kind there is the Greek word species, literally meaning species of things.
Okay.
So when you go to Ephesians 6, the Holy Spirit lists archai, cosmocrator, and pneumonikai. He calls them pneumonikai, and then he refers to one as exousia. So when the Holy Spirit himself, designates the different kinds, he's saying there's this class, there's this type, there's this species. But regardless, there's, like in Timothy 2, the Holy Spirit calls them planos spirits, meaning seducing imposters. So regardless of those definitions, which are important because the Holy Spirit gave them, and it deals with their function. They're all of the same source, though. Whether you would say, well, these are the Nephilim spirits, or Jesus made no distinction when he just simply dealt with unclean spirits, he just did it. Whether, regardless of if they're of the dark side origin, they're finite, they're under the rights of our, you know, the authority we've been given is over all the power of the enemy.
Yes.
So we just take authority. So whatever they say, because a lot of them will come out, I am the right, I am the great one, you know, there's this, you know, arrogance, there's, I won't leave, and I have rights. Well, you know what? I have the authority of Christ. I take away your rights. I
Amen.
Supersede your rights.
Oh,
we have
like
rights
that.
To, we have the authority to do that. So, and they're always going to lie. They're always going to look for space. So just take charge, order them, like you do. Sometimes I'll, but I will ask the Spirit of God, even before someone brings somebody in office, and we do this in our training, before someone comes, if they're going to actually bring them to my home or office or whatever, and they say, well, we've got a demonized guy we're bringing over, I will prayer map that ahead of time. What I mean by that is this. Get a piece of paper. The guy's name's Joe, just to say we're Joe or whatever. Lord, what is up with this guy? Give me a heads up even now. Is there demonic stuff? What's going to go on? You know, give me any preparation. So I'll look for a heads up. And all I'm saying by a prayer map, I'm just simply taking this guy's name and saying, Lord, give me now inside information. If the Holy Spirit can say to Peter or Philip in Acts 8, and he can quote, go stand over there by that chariot. Well, the Holy Spirit can tell me, you know, a few things ahead in advance. So I look for that. And then when they come into the room, sometimes there's instant discernment. Sometimes the Holy Spirit says instantly, 13 or 12, or a name will come up. So all of that can be used then in the deliverance, which I will also, like you say, interrogation. I like that because, command them to, it is important to know how they got in so that the doorways can be willfully, if it's a believer there, to willfully close whatever door they opened or whatever door was opened. If it's a lost person, of course, you want to lead them to Christ instantly after deliverance. And close the doors.
Amen. Folks, if you're just tuning in, we've had Russ Dizdar on for 3 hours. This time has flown by. We've got about 10 minutes remaining. Russ's website, shadowthedarkness.net. I've got three quick rapid-fire questions. Russ, and I want to thank you, brother, for staying over. It's an honor and a pleasure. I like Russ, folks. And you've got to support this brother. He knows what he's talking about. That's clear. And praise God for what you've been doing, brother. Put yourself on the front lines and sharing the knowledge that can help us. Some people have said, I'm looking for the Holy Spirit baptism, but I seem to have some blockage. Have you been able to pinpoint something that could block someone from getting the gift of speaking in tongues? Could it be down to a certain spirit? Any tips on anybody, for anybody out there who has not been able to receive the Holy Spirit? I know it's a gift. What could be a blockage there?
Yeah. I think that anybody is, when it comes to the fullness of the Spirit of God, and any other giftings of the spirits too, any of the Holy Spirit, any other giftings too, you got a couple of things. One thing is be utterly yielded to the Lord Jesus, knowing God's will. Lord, is there anything in my life that is grieving, quenching the Holy Spirit, blocking anything on my part? That I need to repent of right here and right now. And there's no problem saying in a warfare area, Lord, is there anything the enemy's trying to do or whatever? And I find that when individuals, one guy that was seeking just the fullness of the Spirit of God, every time I pray, I see a crowbar. I get a picture of a crowbar in my mind. And I said, the person in writing the story says that all of a sudden they realized, you know, that's the crowbar, because this is a newer believer. That's the crowbar I stole from my employer. It's right here in my garage. He knew that he had to go take it back. He wanted to take it back. He took it back and told his boss, I'm a believer in Christ now. I stole this from you. I apologize. You know, I repented before the Lord. And guess what occurs? He gets all the fullness and power of the Holy Spirit he needed.
Praise God. Amen. Russ, if someone has dabbled in witchcraft, or maybe their parents have, and they believe that they're under a witchcraft curse, how do they go about breaking that? Is it, could it be as simple as renouncing it?
Absolutely. I mean, Absolutely. I mean, that's why I'm saying to every believer that if there's nothing wrong with clearing the air. There's no prohibition by God to say, you know, Lord, like, here's what we do in the course called Freedom Encounters we teach. Psalm 139, the writer says, search me, O God, and see if there's any offensive thing in me, and then lead me in the way everlasting. That's fantastic. Don't be afraid to do that, because God, what is God going to do? He's going to show you anything in your life that is, junk or trash or the enemy and whatever. Lord, so I want to say this. Lord, is there anything in my family's line, my grandfather's, the history, is there anything that I need to renounce? I'm willing, and I'm here, search me, O Lord. I'm willing, show me, bring to my mind, and I'll come up against the Lord. I'll renounce it over my family line. I'll renounce it in my life, whatever it is, Lord. So when the Lord shows you something, and that's only, again, the Holy Spirit, when he shows you, then you can go ahead and regard whatever it is. You know, all of a sudden you get a real impression of the Holy Spirit that it's something to do with your family line or whatever. Lord Jesus, I renounce any doorway any of my family line has ever given into. Wherever that's occurred, sometimes God gives specifics. Sometimes you learn it from your own family tree. I renounce this in Jesus' name. I sever all ties with the past here. I claim my rights in Christ, the blood of Christ, being born of the Spirit of God, and being under the ownership of God now. And so I renounce this. Sometimes I'll quote Colossians chapter 1 where it says that we've been translated from the dominion of darkness into the kingdom of the Son. I'm in this kingdom now. So I don't have any problem with clearing the air. Go a little overboard. Pray, you know, Lord, I pray over every single thing just to clear the air and make sure. If I have a couch that's been sitting out in the garage, which I do in a second garage out there, I guarantee you it's been out there. My daughter brought it home. It's been out there now for 2 years sitting. Nobody's used it. I will not go out there instantly, pick it up, and bring it to the house. Why? Might be some bugs on it. There might be some. There might be a rat that got up in it. Who knows? I want to make sure all that's gone.
Yeah.
So there's nothing wrong with looking at it, rattling the cage. So how do you do that? Psalm 139, search me, O God. You know, show me, family line, Lord, show me anything. And just, I like to take a piece of paper and put it in front of me. And if the Lord speaks to my heart, I wrote this up. If the Lord gives me a verse of Scripture, I'll mark that down. I'll go look up that Scripture. And if that has something to do with some doorway or something, then whatever it may be, whether family line, some other door, something that I didn't, like me, again, you got to remember, like Cheech and Chong getting saved, you don't remember everything right away. So when I think back into the 60s, the late 60s, and think, I cannot believe, and I'll say, I did this, I did that. And Lord, even though I don't feel an effect right now, I'll say, Lord, I renounce that. Nothing wrong with that.
Amen.
But especially if you do feel something.
Praise God. Rebecca Brown, she wrote many books. Some have said she's still in witchcraft. Others said she was the real deal. What's your personal take on that?
I just saw her face-to-face in a meeting down here in my area. I read all her materials, years ago. I contacted her husband when he talked to Daniel Yoder direct years ago. I can't tell you. I mean, I cannot say I have anything from God that tells me that she's still any kind of stuff. When I heard her down there, she was defiantly committed to the Lord and sharing warfare stuff so I listened to her for maybe 2 hours of all that she had to say. I only say that what I observed, she's pretty much of a singular believer to where she learns everything and doesn't want to learn from anybody else in a sense. And I think that's a disadvantage when somebody says, well, I'll just learn on my own. I'm not going to learn from anybody else. The Word of God says in Proverbs, walk with the wise and you will grow wise. I want to learn from other people. I want to hear what God is saying through other people and the giftings they have. So all I can say by my observation is in the book materials, I don't think she was correct on some things. In my observation of her face-to-face, and from listening to her, I cannot tell you that God at all gave me a warning or said, but I don't know her whole life. I didn't get to talk to her face to face. She's too busy, and I was heading for Nashville that night anyway. That's all I can say concerning that I know.
That's a fair answer, Russ. It's been an honor and pleasure to have you on tonight. There's so many more things we could talk about, but you know, look, I'm going to have you back like 100 times, just to scratch the surface. How can people
bless
get involved
you,
with you and get involved in your ministry? Support it.
Sure.
You're also doing crusades sometimes. Let's see, with Minister Fortson. I think y'all have done some conferences together out in Vegas. Do you have some?
Yeah, we've had conferences. Yeah, I'll be at the Future Congress coming up with Tom Horn and Missler and all those guys. That's in July. If they go to shadowthedarkness.net, they'll see when the conferences and speaking engagements are coming. There's a bunch of courses, training courses, that are all free that anybody can get that wants a little training. And then if you and I want to get together in the future and do a conference and do kind of a crusade,
man,
Shannon, I'm willing to come there and let's do it together.
Brother, we're going to do it. I was talking to Rich Keltner. We want to get Rumble in the Concrete Jungle, New York City, going next.
That's good.
Rumble in Sin City in Las Vegas. We're going to do it. I'm going to contact you this week. Brother, God bless you for coming on tonight.
Thank you very much, brother. Love you.
And pleasure
to you.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. Folks, you've got to check out shadowthedarkness.net. Shatterthedarkness.net. Go over there, order the materials, get involved with Russ Dizdar, support his ministry. This brother knows what he's talking about. I praise God for him. I've enjoyed this program. I would encourage everyone to send copies of this program to everyone they know. And keep him in prayer. Keep me in prayer. Tomorrow night, Scott Lathrop will be on Omega Man Radio Channel. God bless everyone for tuning in. We'll see you tomorrow night. Thank you.